everyone would start taking your seats. This is the, let's say the 2 minute, maybe 1 minute warning. I went down and visited with the Credentials Committee, who has worked extremely hard. They have had a very, very heavy workload, but they have, they've done their part. And as soon as we get everyone back to their seats, then we will start up with the business of the convention. I would ask those who are at the doors for your help to let those who are still in the hallway know to come in and please take their seats. I would ask all of those who are in the back milling about, if you would please take your seats before I call order to the House. Because when I call order to the House, then we'll ask the Sergeant at Arms if they would assist in making sure everyone gets back to their seats. So if you would, please take your seats. Again, thank you for all of the various Facebook messages giving me some tips along the way. I think I've addressed many, if not virtually all, of the concerns that have been raised about seating and air conditioning and volume, etc. That's been very helpful. So if I could get my sergeant at arms to go right back here to area two and ask all of these folks if they would grab your Chick-fil-A sandwich and your soda and make your way back to the to your seat. Session. I would call House to order. I would ask all appropriate delegates who have been selected by the Interim Credentials Committee report to take your seats. And at this time, I am advised that we have a final Credentials Committee report, which we will take up as a first order of business, and then after that we will take up those things that follow. We want to get out of here. I want to get you home. But I want to do our business in accordance with the rules. And so to do both, I need your help. So if everyone would take their seats, cease conversation, and I will now hear from the Credentials Committee report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll ask the members of the Credentials Committee to come up on stage and join behind me. My name is Andrew Turnage. I'm from Union County, and I've had the divine pleasure of serving as the Credentials Committee Chair again for this convention cycle. I appreciate a little bit of laughter that I could see below the spotlight for that. If you've ever served on the Credentials Committee, you realize what a monumental task this committee faces. If you've ever waited on the Credentials Committee, you know what a frustrating process it is to be past lunchtime and not have a Credentials Committee report. One of the things that I can assure you with the committee from the last convention cycle for our national convention, as well as for this one, the organizational convention, is that we have moderated a very thorough and fair process. We have a good bit of representation. Unfortunately, my mind power is gone and I can't remember everyone's name that I've been locked in a room with for 2 days. However, before I present the report, I would ask that you please join me in applause in thanking all of the fine men and women that serve on the committee with me. Moving right along with the report. If you take a look on your screens, should be already in place, you can see the final numbers that the Credentials Committee has voted on. This includes 31 issues that our committee heard from various counties. Those numbers that we have heard and adjudicated have been brought before the Registration Committee, and they are reflected in the numbers that you see on the screen. So if you are looking for the numbers for your county, please look at the screen. The screen will scroll, and you can see the numbers that are on the screen. Taking a look at the columns, you will see a column for delegates allowed, delegates present, and in particular for U County Chairs, the number to elevate, and the final column is the number of alternates that you have available to choose from. Again, take a look at the screens. You can read those numbers at the top of the column. So the screen reflects the majority report of the Credentials Committee. As committee chair, I have the responsibility to also present to you a minority report from the committee. So our majority report is before you on the screens. It's the totals for each of the counties and the numbers that you see before you. And the minority report is, in essence, something for your consideration as well. It is, in essence, a matter that has been brought before the Credentials Committee that you are all familiar with. It is Newton County delegation, and our committee was unable to decide the matter on Newton County because it has been previously ruled on by the state committee. We did not have the authority to make a ruling on all the issues that were brought before us for Newton County. The minority report, in its essence, is this. Members of the Credentials Committee ask that, based upon the qualifications used for the Newton County delegation, that's the point system and their rules, are the issue that the committee had in concern. We do not have jurisdiction to make a ruling or a decision based on points systems, but the minority report is that we don't have authority to make a decision on that. That we are not in favor of the methodology used for that. Mr. Chairman.
First of all, is that a lot of hard work? Thank you. All right, first of all, I want to thank the Credentials Committee for the report. I'm going to walk us all through a quick version of Robert's Rules of Order so that we know how to sort out what you've just heard. You guys can go ahead and take a seat. Great, thanks. So, what we have is a majority report, which is a report to the convention. There is a minority report. If there is a motion to substitute the minority report, then we will vote between the two reports. Is there a motion to substitute? Hold on, just a second. I'm gonna take them one at a time. Microphone one.
Point of order, Mr. Chair.
One second, I'll get to you, Brad. I'm not going to ignore anybody. If you're in a microphone, you're going to be heard, so there's no reason to go, you know, other than being the professionals that we all are. Go right ahead. I have microphone one.
Thank you, Junior. Point of order, the minority report, I believe, is out of order. This decision was already made by the State Appeals Committee. It was already made and presented to the State Committee, and it was already voted on and decided. And the way I understand it, per our current rules, that is the final decision. There cannot be a minority report because there's nothing to report on. The decision is final. I request that you rule it out of order.
Microphone number two.
Make a motion that we accept the majority report of the Credentials Committee.
Okay.
I second that motion.
I have a motion and a second to accept the majority report. Hold on. I'm not going to cut anybody off. I'm going to let everybody be heard. Number three. Microphone right here, three.
I'll make a motion to call the question.
Call the question. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes. Hold on. Okay, I'm coming to you, Brent. I have a motion and a second on the call to question. Brent, number five.
Mr. Chairman,
yes, sir.
I make a motion that we substitute the previous motion and we adopt the minority report in its place.
So I have a motion to substitute.
Second.
Mr. Chairman, by our party rules, we cannot do that.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah,
the convention is sovereign. We decide all issues related to credentials, as you know. We are the final arbiter of credentials here assembled. And so it's absolutely in order.
Mr. Chairman, point of order.
Hold on. I got to find who that is. Okay, number two.
Make
yes.
A motion to accept the majority report of the Credentials Committee. It's been seconded. It should be voted on.
Okay. Number one?
Mr. Chair,
yes.
Initially asked for us to make a motion to substitute so we would be able to choose between the two motions. I immediately so moved, even though I wasn't closest to the microphone, and I would ask that you respectfully honor my motion that was made before the gentleman that preceded me at this microphone.
Mm-hmm. Others? Anybody else want to speak to this issue? Does anyone else want to speak to this issue? Right
Mr.
here.
Chairman, point of order.
All I need you to do is let me call on you because they'll keep the microphones off so we don't pick up background noise until I call on you. Number three?
The question, there's been a call of the question and it has been seconded. I believe that we should move on to that vote and then continue on down the chain.
Is there any other discussion on the matters that are on the floor?
Mr. Chairman.
Hold on, where am I? Number four?
Mr. Chairman, point of order here. Number four,
yes?
I have listed here 39 delegates and to move up seven, but I had one registered delegate that went home terribly ill. Am I allowed to move up that?
We'll come to that after we adopt the report. Could you just hang tight with me for a minute?
Okay, I'll
because
be tight.
Otherwise, I'd have to just rule you out of order till we finish this discussion.
Okay, carry on.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that wants to speak to the matters that are on the floor?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Hold on, right here. Where am I?
Five. Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
For clarity's sake, we have two delegations, two reports coming out of the Credentials Committee, the Credentials Committee report and the Minority Report. The one seats Newton County, and the other one seats none of that county, because there was a great controversy there, as most of us know, which seems to me to be the fair position. It seems to me, for clarity's sake, we ought to have a clean vote. Are we for the majority report or the minority report? And it is that motion that I make, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Is there any other discussion? Okay, now remember, I can only let you talk twice to the motion. So if you've already talked once, you're down to your last strike.
Yes, sir.
Number one?
Just to make sure people understand why this is important, there is a rule, state party rules, that says that you are not allowed to exclude people at the mass precinct meeting as long as they hold to the Republican Party principles. According to the controversy, Newton County did not let certain people participate who held to those principles, and that's why they're asking for the delegates from Newton to not be seated, so that we're not excluding people that should have been admitted and letting people in that did so by violating the rules of the state party.
Okay.
There you go.
You actually don't need a point. Right now, you don't even need a point of order, but go right ahead.
Chair, microphone one.
No, I'm on three. I'm on three, and then I'll come to one.
Since the minority report is a violation of the rules, do we need a two-thirds vote to suspend the rules?
No, you do not need a two-thirds vote. Go right ahead. Number five, did you have a comment? Microphone five, did you have...
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Is it not true that while the point system has many supporters, is it not also true that one of the individuals who was not allowed to participate in Newton has donated tens of thousands of dollars to the Republican Party and is about as involved as you can be? This is obviously a travesty of justice for one-fourth to deny the other three-fourths. This is not apartheid South Africa. This is the United States.
Yay and nay have been made to the Appeals Committee, and that all of that was taken into account. Yes.
Mr. Chairman.
Number three, yes.
Mr. Chairman, this has been through the Appeals Committee, this has been through the County Committee, the District Committee, this has been through the State Committee. By rules, and they can say all they want about donations. By rules, this has been settled at the state committee meeting.
Thank you. So, anything further? If not, then I will prepare to take the vote. Here is the ruling of the chair. So, I'm sorry, number one.
On my last strike.
Yes, your last one.
The original request was that the minority report was out of order, and I still stand by that.
You have made the request.
I want to read it. We have ruled on this. The State Appeals Committee ruled, and the State Committee voted on it, and basically because the appeal was incorrectly presented. It's just everybody's quoting rules. I don't have the rules on my iPad. I don't have an iPad. But nobody on either side, if you want to get down into the weeds, nobody was following the rules. And as I said, if we have a State Appeals Committee and a State Committee, what is the point of having one of them if they are not the final decision maker?
Number two, and I think this is your second time, so this is your last time. Go ahead.
Chairman, I appeal to the delegates of the floor that our delegates' votes are not for sale. That we're to follow rules as the chairman of the Newton County Republican Party has made an effort to do. And that those people who were not seated have had a right for the past 2 years to participate in the Newton County Republican Party meetings. They've known about the point system because they even made the appeals to this body 2 years ago. So this is not something new. It hasn't been a surprise. It's disconcerting that we're even having to take up your time with this. But I will submit to you that our votes are not for sale, that we want to vote according to the rules and not have an anarchy going on. Thank you very much for your comment.
Okay. Number two, yes. Is this your first time?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Part of the State Committee was not allowed to hear all of the facts in Newton County. We were allowed only to hear that someone had improperly appealed. That's all we ruled on. We did not rule on someone stopping somebody from being a delegate.
Thank you. Number five.
Mr. Chairman.
Hold on, I gotta get you turned on, man. Number five.
Mr. Chairman.
Is this your second time?
Yes, sir. In regards to the State Committee, we received a 30-minute notice, no written report. We were told that the Appeals Committee had met by phone at night, and we were not allowed to hear anything but be told, you've got to vote like this. That sounds a lot more like, you've got to pass the bill before you can read it, than it does the Republican Party. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. You're the last comment, and then we will vote. I will
point
roll
of information, sir.
Where? Hold on, let me do three. Where's my point
number
of information?
Number
at?
One. Point
all right,
of
hold on one. Precedence. Three, you're the last debate. One, you'll be the last point of information, okay? This all right, go right ahead.
Parliamentary inquiry. When the question is called and seconded, is that not supposed to end debate and move directly into a vote?
I will rule on those, all of the points of order momentarily. Yes, and so we have a point of information and one, and then I will rule and then we will vote.
Point of information, sir.
Yes.
What is the minority report? Is the minority report that Newton County shall not be seated at all, or is it something else?
That's it. This is all about the seating or not seating of Newton County.
Okay, so okay. It's seat them according to the majority report or don't seat them at all?
You put it perfectly. I actually think you could come up here and probably do as good a cheer job as I am.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So now we're about to vote, and I'm going to rule on the various points of order. So here is the ruling of the chair. The ruling of the chair is that I have before me a motion to adopt the majority report seconded with a call to question. And my ruling is that we will vote on that motion with this clarification given the other motions that were made afterwards. If you vote for the majority report, then you vote for the majority report. I will then call for votes on the minority report. And if you vote for the minority report, that will be a vote for the minority report. Whichever report gets the most votes, that will be the report that will govern the convention. Does everybody understand the ruling of the chair? Okay, are we clear? Now, just for those parliamentary buffs out there, what I have effectively done is I've accepted the principal motion, which was seconded with a move to question. And then I have relegated Mr. Frost's motion, which is a motion to convert the nay vote into a vote on the minority report. So here we go. This is easy. If you're for the majority report, which will seat Newton County, if you are for the majority report, which will seat Newton County, please stand up. If you are for the majority report, please stand up. If you're for the majority report, please stand up. All right? Just because this is a very important issue, because it controls the seating, I will ask the sergeant at arms to count those standing. Please remain standing until someone tells you to sit down. Please remain, not, if you're for the majority report, please remain standing until you are instructed otherwise. Each sergeant at arm at a mic, count your section, please. If you're at a mic, count your section. Just hang tight. screen here to keep scrolling, just so that county chairs who miss their county can see it. It'll be of consequence to everybody but Newton, and we'll see if it's of consequence there.
Holding.
Newton, there we go, Paulding, Richmond, and Walton. I'm going to read those again while they're finishing up the tally. Bartow Chair, come on up. Carroll, Chatham, Cherokee, Clark, Daugherty, Fayette, Floyd, Hall, Lowndes, Muskogee, Paulding, Richmond, Walton. I need you to come up, get your packet. Go ahead, get started. Yes. Okay, so if I called your name as a candidate, we'll get this done here. If I called your name, you were in over 80,000 county, and I need you to go to the table that I just described, which is the one right here where everyone's lined up. If you are an under 80, then you will, in a moment, as soon as I announce the results of the vote, go to the other table to get the packet that allows you to move people up. Are you, everybody understand what we're about to do? Okay. So on the motion to adopt the majority report, the vote is 676 to adopt the majority report, 489 to adopt the minority report. The majority report is adopted. Now what I need is the under 80s to go over to the other table, if you're a chair, and get your materials to move your delegates up. If you have alternates here, go there. Meanwhile, yeah, okay, I'll get to that when we're done. Okay. While we're doing that, we have a couple of just kind of ministerial orders of business. The first ministerial order is the adoption of the agenda, which is in your book. If you look in your book, there's an agenda. And what I actually need is someone to make a motion to adopt the agenda. I'm sorry? Motion to adopt. Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Hearing none, the ayes have it, and the agenda is adopted. The next order of business is the election of a convention chairman. Is there a nomination? Is there a second? Is there any other nominations? A motion to close nominations. Is there a second? All those in favor say aye. All those opposed say nay. Thank you. I appreciate you, actually. Next will be the election of a convention secretary. I think we have a nomination of Debbie McCord. Is there a second? Any other nominations? We have a motion the nominations be closed. Is there a second? All those in favor say aye. Here, opposed, nay. Debbie, you're more popular than me. Debbie McCord is the convention secretary. As far as appointments, I appoint John White and as my parliamentarian, and Margaret Holliman as the assistant parliamentarian, Stefan Passantino as the general counsel, and I appoint the convention, interim conventions committees to become permanent nominations committees. Now let me see, we've got a little bit of congestion here moving people up. However, unless there's an objection, I will hear from the nominations committee just to give their report, but not to take any action, because I don't want to take action while people are doing other things. Is there objection to just hearing the report? Hearing none, is it Frank? Yeah, Frank, come on up.
Good
served on the nominations committee. Would you please come to the stage? If you served on the nominations committee, please come to the stage.
To identify the members of the committee who are standing behind me on the stage. They are as follows: Tom Sharp from the 1st District, Ryan Cleveland from the 2nd District, John Knopp from the 3rd, Rachel Little from the 4th, Vincent Russo from the 5th, Michael Fitzgerald from the 6th, Julianne Thompson from the 7th, Anthony Morris from the 8th, Bruce Azevedo from the 9th, Jay Hanley from the 10th, Scott Johnson, 11th, Brittany Dasher, 12th, Matthew Kroll, 13th, Robert Smith from the 14th. The nominating committee met from 10 o'clock a.m. until about 2 p.m. on Friday, yesterday. And we're pleased to present our report to this convention. I'm going to take these in ascending order. The nominating committee's recommendation for the Office of Assistant Secretary is Layla Shipman. For the Office of Secretary, Kirk Shook. For Assistant Treasurer, John Wallace. For Treasurer, Mansell McCord. For Second Vice Chair, Debbie McCord. For First Vice Chairman, Michael McNeely. For Chairman, John Padgett.
Thank all of you for the service. I am going to, I am told that we have no rules changes, so that I could take, I think we could go ahead and do rules while we're doing this, but I actually need a motion to amend the agenda to permit us to go through rules. Is there a motion? Is there a second? All those in favor say aye. Opposed, nay. Hearing none, the ayes have it. We'll hear from the Rules Committee.
Well, thank you very much, Randy. Stole all my thunder there. This is going to be my gift to everyone, that the Permanent and the Temporary Rules Committees met and considered a number of proposed changes to the rules. As you might recall, just this past March, we underwent a fairly comprehensive overhaul of the rules. And in light of the amount of time that had been spent on that and the amount of time that it might take to go through rules again today, we decided it would make sense to hold on to any proposed changes, allow the chairman to appoint the new rules committee, and allow them to undertake those rules, any proposed changes to the rules. So at this point, the rules committee is going to propose that the convention adopt the current rules of the Republican Party as they currently exist.
You've heard the report of the Rules Committee. I am shocked that talented lawyers could not find one comma or T or I. But be that as it may, is there a motion to adopt the Rules Committee of the Rules? Is there a second? Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye. All those opposed say nay. The ayes have it. We are completed with the Rules Committee. We are still completing the process here, but you can tell that we're almost to the end of getting everybody where they can move folks up. I want to spend a minute while they're doing that explaining to you how we're going to vote. So does everybody have your ballots? Okay? So what we do when we get ready to vote is I will tell you the ballot number. You notice on the upper right-hand corner, it says number one, then it says number two. On the second one, it says number three. On the third one, it says number four. I will tell you a ballot to take. Are you with me? All right, and then I will assign a number to a candidate. So if you look across the very top, there's 1 through 10. So for example, I would say, if you want to vote for Hillary Clinton, you mark the number 10. And I will then say, please also, you're in the wrong room. And then I would say, and if you're for Ronald Reagan, mark the number 1. So do you see how it works? Now the most important thing when we get to the rules is that you tear off only the ballot that I tell you to, because we're going to need other ballots. To tear off only the ballot that I tell you to, mark that one ballot. Notice there'll be no identifying information, so it'll be a secret ballot. Take it then and just fold it down the middle if you're worried that somebody might be taking a peek at how you voted. And then you will, the sergeant-at-arms will come through and you'll either give it to them, you can pass it down the row if you don't want to do that, or you can put it in the box yourself. So does everybody understand how the voting will work? Okay? So if you don't have your booklet, get your booklet out, get it ready. I know that I originally thought that I had gotten a bunch of lottery tickets. It was very helpful, but that's not what this is. This is going to be our official ballot. Now, while we're waiting on the remainder, I thought, if this was okay with you, that we might hear but not vote on the Resolutions Committee report. Is everybody okay with that? Just to hear them to get the reading out of the way. So I need a motion to change the agenda to permit us to hear from resolutions. Is there a second? All those in favor say aye. Opposed, nay. Hearing none, the ayes have it. I would ask the Resolutions Committee to come up and let's hear their report. Resolutions, would the full committee come up along with the chair to give us the Resolutions Committee report? I would ask if you would to put the resolutions up on the screen for folks so that they can see them as the chairman report. So go ahead. Oh, I see that they're ahead of us.
Can we have Senator Schaefer, please? Come up to the podium, Senator Schaefer. Chair, I'm not going to call out everybody's name. I don't have it in front of me. So, move to the resolutions. And yeah, they're on your screen, and hopefully they're large enough for you to see this year. Okay. Republican Principles Resolution. Whereas the Republican Party is the party of small government and individual freedom and responsibility, along with respect for traditional family values and respect for human life. And whereas the Republican Party wishes to expand its membership while adhering to its principles. Therefore, be it resolved that the Republican Party welcomes all members who are in accord with the following principles. I believe in individual responsibility and freedom. I believe that government has become too big and should be reduced to be as small and as transparent as possible. I believe that decisions should be made as locally as possible and that all levels of government should be used to protect the rights and freedoms of individuals. I believe that governments should live within their means and not burden future administrations or generations of taxpayers with debt. A resolution affirming the privilege of U.S. citizenship. Whereas America is a nation of immigrants, and the Republican Party appreciates the contributions of all legal immigrants in this nation, and whereas citizenship in this great nation is a precious and desirable privilege, and whereas American government is one of laws and not men, therefore be it resolved by the 2015 Georgia GOP State Convention delegates that our immigration policy must be based on the following legislative priorities. The rule of law requires the fair, firm, and consistent enforcement of the law, and immigration is no exception. The elimination of presidential executive orders, directives, and memoranda currently enforced in the area of immigration in the United States. America's immigration system must be a national strength and not a strategic vulnerability. Any temporary worker program must be temporary, market-oriented, and feasible. The governor of Georgia and the Georgia General Assembly shall alter existing law so as to honor its intent to ensure that all illegal aliens are prohibited from accessing any type of legal permission to operate any motor vehicle on any public road in our great state. Finally, be it resolved that the Secretary of the 2015 Georgia GOP State Convention is directed to immediately transmit an appropriate copy of this resolution to all elected Republican officials serving in the great state of Georgia at both the state and federal levels. I'm going to take a break just a moment before I read the rest of you to tell you a little bit about how this came to be, just real quick. There were over 20 resolutions submitted to the committee. The committee, first of all, first thing we did was we took off our committee hats and we put on our delegate hats to understand how many y'all would, how we would feel about the number. So we set a target, starting with the end in mind. And then we started a 2-minute session for everybody to advocate for or against resolutions. At the end of that time, we took a break and everybody ranked the resolutions from highest to lowest. And then we compiled that and we started debating them, and these are the ones that we are bringing to you today. I will continue. We have a resolution concerning advanced placement in U.S. history, otherwise known as A Push. Whereas approximately 14,000 Georgia students take the College Board's Advanced Placement in U.S. History, A Push course each year, and whereas the College Board, a private organization unaccountable to the public, released a new framework for the AP Push course that reflects a radically revisionist view of American history that emphasizes negative aspects of our nation's history while omitting and minimizing positive aspects. And whereas the AP Push course has traditionally been designed to present a balanced view of American history and to prepare students for college-level history courses. And whereas the College Board recently replaced its brief topic outline with a new lengthy AP Push framework. And whereas the framework describes its detailed requirements as required knowledge for Georgia students. And whereas to prepare their students for the AP Push examination, Georgia AP Push user teachers will have to teach the AP Push required knowledge through the lens of the AP Push themes and concepts to the detriment of the state mandated Georgia performance standards. And whereas the Republican Party supports the principles of free enterprise and competition, and whereas the College Board holds a monopoly over the coursework and testing for college-bound students, and whereas the College Board's revisions for the AP U.S. History framework clearly reveal a leftward bias, and whereas the overall pattern of the College Board appears to be merging the Common Core approach into all AP coursework, elevating skill sets and so-called critical thinking skills over academic rigor and true core knowledge. And whereas Georgia taxpayers provide the funding for professional development activities, textbooks, and AP testing, and whereas Georgia taxpayers should not be locked into only one choice for its college-bound students. Therefore, be it resolved that the 2015 Georgia GOP State Convention delegates encourage our Georgia General Assembly to recommend that the State Board of Education instruct the College Board to return to an approach more compatible with the traditional topic outline, which respects and allows flexibility to incorporate the Georgia Performance Standards for Social Studies in classroom teaching, and specifically incorporates the Georgia Performance Standards emphasis on America's founding principles and the uniqueness of America's role in the world. That the State Board of Education instruct the College Board to return to an AP push examination in alignment with the approach described in paragraph one of this resolution. That the Georgia Congressional Delegation is urged to push for greater market competition with regard to advanced coursework and testing for college-bound students. And that the governor is encouraged to contact other governors of several or all states to join Georgia in efforts to further market competition in advanced subject coursework and subject-based testing for college credit. This one's not up on the PowerPoint, but I wanted to read it.
Oh yeah, well, it's the same. I can't vote for Josh with no driver's license.
A resolution honoring the life and memory of Merritt McKenzie Mack Burgess.
Oh, that one, yeah. But hey, we love the word.
Whereas the citizens of Fulton County and the Fulton County Republican Party mourn the loss of a dedicated Republican with the passing of Mack Burgess on October 14th, 2014. And whereas Mack served Republicans in Fulton County and across Georgia with a tireless work ethic, and whereas his efforts, aided by the campaigns of former Secretary of State Karen Handel, Public Service Commissioner Stan Wise, Tricia Pridmore from Congress, former U.S. Senator Saxby Chambliss, and Governor Nathan Deal, and whereas he worked in leadership in both the Georgia House of Representatives and the Georgia State Senate, and whereas Mack graduated from Centennial High School in Roswell in 2008, magna cum laude, and from the University of Tennessee in Knoxville in 2012, and whereas Mack was a recipient of the Shirley and Bill Weir Foundation Scholarship, which provides a full four-year scholarship to the university of his choice, and whereas upon graduation, Mack was named to the selection committee of the foundation and was the first Weir Scholar to assume this honor and responsibility of awarding the scholarship to other deserving students. Young Georgians. And whereas Mack was a lifelong resident of Fulton County, and whereas he was an avid golfer, writer, musician, sailor, and political debater, and whereas Mack was a rising star in the Republican Party and in the world, a life taken far too soon, a person who made the world a better place just by being in it, a friend who all who knew him, loyal, honest, genuine, and compassionate, kind, and devoted. And whereas Mack inspired those around him to do and to be the best, now therefore be it resolved by the Georgia Republican Party that the members of this body join in honoring his life, the life and memory of Mack Burgess, and express their deepest and most sincere regret at his passing. Be it further resolved that the Secretary of the Georgia Republican Party is authorized and directed to make appropriate copies of the resolution to the distribution of his family, Mack Burgess.
Exercise Chairman's prerogative here to ask that we adopt that resolution by acclamation. Is there a motion? and a second. Everybody in favor say aye.
Aye.
Adopted.
This was a very tough year for the party and the party faithful in the sense of passings and in the sense of trying to prepare for this. The committee reached the conclusion that rather than prepare individual resolutions for every single person, we would read the names of those that had passed and that we will prepare resolutions and direct them to the state committee for the committee to adopt into the permanent record. These are individuals that have served the party and had passed in the previous year. Phil Foyle, Ray Newman, Catherine Neff, Edward Brock, Deborah Golder, Dick Dickey, Dick Donnelly, Harry Allen Sachs Jr., Walt Van Nordstrom, Bud Villeneuve, Charlotte Hester, Joe Robert, Linda Ruggiero, Calvin Hill, Joseph Roberts, Tom Cooper, Chuck Ward, Colonel Al Rowe, Vonis Wagner Coverdale, Sandra Thompson, Travis Roberts, Pat Allen, Fred Allen, Kit Klein, Earl Stein, Andy Estes, Justin L., Larry Long, Mary Ann Pittman, Dean Fripp, Walter Bryan, Sleen Richardson, Randolph Thrower, Marilyn Foster, Tom Lowe, Bonnie Williams, Joan Zeller, Heather Alvarez, Lynn Breck, Harvey Chambers, Kurt Moore, Howard Bo Calloway, Gabriel Mironoff, Oliver Mironoff, Michael Whitney, Dennis Kane, Robert Ramsour, Dexter Lovins, Johnny Chronic, Jeffrey Lifesey, Jerry LeGuire, Ron Bomberg, Dennis Pitts, Ralph Robinson, Bob Poole, Ray Davis, Babs Carter, Jamie Oglesby, Clarence Bud Sorcy, Henry Gessinger, Joey Brush.
So do I hear a motion to authorize the state committee to issue resolutions honoring the memory of the list that we just heard? Is there a second? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Nays nay. Hearing none, the ayes have it. The state committee is so authorized.
We have a special one for Rick. We're waiting on Senator to read Rick's. Back to the PowerPoint. Continuing, a resolution to elect State Board of Education members and retain elected control of the state superintendent post. Whereas the Georgia State Board of Education, SBOE, members are currently appointed by the sitting governor for 7-year terms and are not accountable to the people. And whereas more than half the state budget is spent on K-12 and higher education. And whereas appointed SBOE members have no incentive to reflect the values, wishes, and inputs of voters in their congressional districts in education and decision making. And whereas in 2013, the Republican Republican National Committee and the Georgia Republican State Committee unanimously supported resolutions to rid our states and Georgia specifically of Common Core. And whereas in 2014, Georgia board voters elected a state school board school superintendent who was opposed to the Common Core national standards, electing him in margins that exceeded the ballots cast for either the post of U.S. Senate or the post of governor, even though these races appeared on the first page of the ballot and the superintendent's race appeared on the fifth page of the ballot. And whereas the power of the unelected SBOE members supersedes the power of the elected superintendent in many important areas, such as the ability to set the agenda for the State Board of Education meetings, hire and fire staff, and even direct staff within the Department of Education. And whereas in a recent study committee on Common Core, the entire SBOE signed off on Common Core standards after making only minor tweaks to the standards, despite significant documented deficiencies in both the English language arts and mathematics standards. And whereas the SBOE members recently changed the name of the Common Core for Georgia Performance Standards to Georgia Standards of Excellence to appear that Georgia was no longer in Common Core, and whereas the SBOE members have failed to challenge the College Board's new history framework for advanced placement U.S. American history, known as AP Push, which advances a negative view of American history, and whereas these actions, as well as inactions by the appointed SBOE members, have not reflected the wishes of the people of Georgia, and whereas increasing SBOE accountability to the people of Georgia requires direct elections, and whereas the change in the way the SBOE members are elected would require a constitutional amendment, they'll therefore be it resolved the 2015 Georgia Republican State Convention delegates urge the members of the Georgia legislature to introduce a constitutional amendment which would allow for the voters in each congressional district to elect their own representative to the state school board. And be it further resolved, we the delegates, be it further resolved, we the delegates to the Georgia Republican State Convention oppose all efforts that would take away our right to elect our state school superintendent and urge members of the Georgia legislature to oppose all efforts to change the Constitution to allow for the appointment of a state school superintendent. Finally, be it resolved that the Secretary of the Georgia Republican Party Convention is directed to immediately transmit an appropriate copy of this and all elected to all elected Republican officials in the Georgia Senate and the Georgia House, to the Honorable Nathan Deal, Governor of the State of Georgia, the Honorable Casey Kasem, Hagel, Lieutenant Governor of the State of Georgia, and to the Honorable David Ralston, Speaker of the House of Representatives. Are you ready to meet your
name? Yeah, I'm ready for the last one.
Actually, I have two. I have three. Do you want
three
me
more?
To, yeah,
okay.
Keep going.
No, that's fine. Do you want?
We tried to keep it short. We actually merged several to speed up the process. A resolution supporting the SEC primary and directing the Georgia Republican Party to study the Georgia Republican primary process. Whereas there has been a call among the grassroots of the Georgia Republican Party to reform the current Republican nominating process. Whereas the State Committee of the Georgia Republican Party will be setting the ground rules for the delegate apportionment into the 2016 Republican National Committee Convention. And whereas Georgia's participation in the SEC primary under the leadership of Secretary of State Brian Kemp has raised Georgia's profile in the 2016 presidential primaries. And whereas the Georgia Republican Party seeks to be a proactive organization and embrace new and different methods to grow the Republican base through the conservative movement. Whereas the designation of an elected office candidate as a Republican is a title granted by the will of the members of the party. Therefore, it be resolved that the Georgia Republican Party, through a study committee, shall study the impact of changing to the Republican presidential and state primary process. The committee shall report its findings to the state committee in such a time that the state committee may make a request of the Georgia General Assembly to change any applicable election laws during the 2016 session in the Georgia General Assembly. The committee shall be appointed by the chairman of the Georgia Republican Party with the following conditions. There shall be at least one representative from each of the 14 congressional districts, and the chairman shall appoint one member as chairman of the study committee. Now the one y'all have all been waiting for. Whereas, a resolution on protecting religious liberty. Whereas many of the first immigrants to the New World were motivated by their desire for religious liberty so that they could practice their faith in all aspects of their lives according to the dictates of their own consciences. And whereas upon this great principle, the First Amendment of the United States Constitution states, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech. And whereas every elected official in the state of Georgia makes an oath or affirmation to uphold the United States Constitution, as it is written, not as a judicial body may interpret it, including this provision from the First Amendment. And whereas in Employment Division v. Smith, 1990, the U.S. Supreme Court held that under the First Amendment, a government may burden the exercise of religion with a law of neutral application as long as the government can show a rational basis for its action. And whereas under this rational basis test, a government has much more power to burden exercise of religion than it would if required to show a compelling interest for its action. And whereas in 1993, Congress passed the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, RFRA, by a unanimous vote in the House of Representatives and a 97-3 vote in the Senate, replacing the rational basis test with the more protective, compelling interest test. Whereas RFRA has proven to be an effective buttress for religious liberty, ensuring that federal laws and federal policies, even those that appear to be neutral towards religion on their face, cannot substantially burden religious liberty without a compelling state interest and with the least restrictive means. And whereas RFRA was the leading reason that religious liberty claims were upheld by the U.S. Supreme Court in Burwell v. Hobby Lobby, ensuring that the Affordable Care Act could not coerce business owners holding sincere religious beliefs to violate their conscience and force them to include abortion-inducing drugs in their insurance coverage for employees. And whereas RFRA applies only to federal laws and federal policies and cannot protect religious freedom against state and local government action, thus necessitating the states pass their own RFRAs, as now 20 or more states have done, including all states that are contiguous to the state of Georgia. And whereas at least 10 additional states have imposed RFRA protections by judicial actions. And whereas in the over two decades that RFRA protections have been in effect in the federal level, as well as in the majority of states, there's never been a case in which those protections have been used to permit evils such as child abuse or illegal discrimination. And whereas religious liberty has been increasingly under attack in the state of Georgia, as evidenced by restrictions on Christian clubs at some states' universities, denial of after-school Bible clubs in K-12 schools, restrictions against placing Bibles in public libraries, and zoning restrictions to deny churches the use of their own property. And whereas we commend the Georgia State Senate for passing Senate Bill 129, the Georgia Religious Freedom Restoration Act, that would provide the RFRA protections for people of faith in the state of Georgia. Therefore, it be it resolved that the 2015 Georgia Republican Party State Convention delegates urge the Georgia House of Representatives to pass State Bill 129, the Georgia Religious Freedom Restoration Act, without amendments, and further urges the governor of the state of Georgia to sign that bill so that the people of faith will be protected from unwarranted governmental burdening of their exercise of faith. And further be resolved that the Secretary of the 2015 Georgia Republican Party State Convention is directed to immediately transmit an appropriate copy of this resolution to all elected Republican officials in the Georgia Senate and in the Georgia House, to the Honorable Nathan Deal, Governor of the State of Georgia, the Honorable Casey Cable, Lieutenant Governor of the State of Georgia, and to the Honorable David Ralston, Speaker of the House of Representatives.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Rick Richardson was a good friend and a tremendous Republican. I know many of you were friends with him out here, and I'm honored to read a resolution that was offered in the Senate by Senator David Schaefer. So I'll read that resolution now. Senate Resolution 638 by Senator Schaefer, the 48th, Mollison, the 53rd, McCuna, the 29th, and Malara, the 40th. A resolution honoring the life and memory of Atticus Allen Rick Richardson, and for other purposes. Whereas the state of Georgia mourns the loss of Atticus Allen Rick Richardson, who unexpectedly passed away on November 14th, 2014, And whereas Rick Richardson was born on December 5th, 1956 in Atlanta, Georgia, the beloved son of the late A.A. and Willie Richardson. And whereas he is survived by his mother, Willie, his sister, Lee, his nephew, Brett, Zachary, and other numerous cousins. And whereas he was one of the organizational leaders and chairman of the DeKalb County Republican Party, helping to build membership, recruit candidates, raise money, and enlist the volunteers needed to elect Republicans locally and statewide. And whereas Rick Richardson brought young Georgians into the Republican Party with his commitment to and eventual chairmanship of the Young Republicans of Georgia organization, culminating with his success in bringing the Young Republicans National Convention to Atlanta in 1995. And whereas he led Georgia's 4th Congressional District Republican Party, encouraging regional cooperation among local and state Republicans, allowing for maximization of resources and the election of quality individuals to all levels of government in Georgia. And whereas he was executive director of the Fulton County Republican Party, and later executive assistant to the chairman of the Georgia Republican Party, modernizing the party's data infrastructure and technical processes, and unifying divergent political factions across the state. And whereas Rick Richardson's contribution to the Republican Party and the entire state of Georgia are admired and deeply appreciated by all persons who call Georgia home, now therefore be it resolved by the Senate that the members of this body join in honoring the life and memory of Atticus Allen Rick Richardson and express their deepest and most sincere regret at his passing. Be it further resolved that the Secretary of the Senate is authorized and directed to make appropriate copy of this resolution available for distribution to the family of Atticus Allen Rick Richardson. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
So in my faith, when we pass, we go to be with the Lord and we look down. When you vote on this resolution, I want you to let Rich Richardson hear you, okay? All those in favor of the last resolution, please say aye.
Aye!
He was a great man. Thank you for the resolution. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, we omitted a name off the list for the state committee, and that would be Mayor Eva Galambos.
Do I hear a motion to amend the prior motion to add Eva Galambos? Second? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed nay. Hearing none, the ayes have it. The motion is adopted. We will take the resolutions up at their appropriate time after we've now finished the next order of the business, which is the election of officers. Okay, are we ready? Everybody ready? My first order is to accept nominations. Is to accept nominations for the various offices that are up. Let's see, number 5.
Mr. Chairman,
yes?
I'd like to move that we accept the nominating committee slate.
No!
We have a motion to elect the slate, number 2. And I have a second. Is there a discussion? A point of order is at number 3.
Yes, the point of order is, according to Robert's Rules of Order, any motion to close nominations from the floor before ample time has been granted for nominations is out of order.
I completely agree with you, but as my parliamentarian is about to whisper in my ear that which I know well, which is that a motion to elect by slate is not a motion to close nominations. Are there any other discussion? Now this is your chance to debate the motion. If you want to elect the slate proposed by the nominating committee, you will end up voting yes. If you vote no, then we will proceed office by office. So if you'd like to speak to the motion, I don't want anyone thinking you've had not an opportunity. So first let me do number 3, and then Daryl, I see you. Were you at number 4? Okay, and now I'll come to number 4, and then I'll go to number 5, and then we'll work our way through. So what did I say, a 3? Yeah, go right ahead.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, Newgalius, Columbia County, we close nominations.
I will rule that motion out of order only because I have a pending motion on the floor. Yes.
Point of order.
Yes, go right ahead, Daryl.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman. Don't we need a final credentials report telling us how many people were moved forward so that we know the total voting strength of the convention?
We did get a total credentials report, or final credentials report, but
they said how many could move up, but we usually get one to tell us if everybody was moved up.
We did get it, but I'll get it again. Okay, how about that? So before we vote, I will get the total voting strength of the floor. So I'll ask my credentials committee chairman if he would to bring me that number back up. Also, I was handed here an announcement. If anyone found a wallet, a gentleman from Raymond County has lost his, and so if you're in the Raymond County area, maybe around, look around, see if you see it. I just want to make sure that I know how I would be if I lost mine. Where am I at? Number five? Go ahead, Brad.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
We're not going to close nominations without having nominations made from the floor, are we?
Well, as I understand it, if we adopt a motion to adopt a slate, I would then accept alternative slates pursuant to the nominations process.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion that we elect by individual office, not by slate. We have 10 offices here. We need to have a fair and open convention, Randy, Mr. Chairman. Let's have that vote.
Rand, I think the appropriate remedy then is to vote no. Then I can take up your motion.
Mr. Chair, we don't need to vote no. We need to take nominations by office, one at a time, fairly and clearly, and then vote on them. I have to have parliamentary shenanigans.
I have to just go by the rules, really. So number four, number four, anything?
Yes.
Me?
Yes.
Yes. My name is Terry Green.
Holding up the phone. That was good.
My name is Terry Green. I would like to nominate Alex Johnson for chairman of the Georgia Republican Party.
Any other discussion on the motion on the floor? The motion on the floor being a motion to elect a slate. Is there any other motion? Yes, sir. This is your second time, though, right?
Yes, sir.
On this question?
Yes, sir.
All right, go right ahead.
Yes, Columbia County. I move that we call a question, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
One second. I'm going to rule that call the question out of order only because there's clearly other people who want to be heard, and I want to give everybody a chance to be heard here. But I will entertain, once we have proceeded with the debate, to call the question. Number one?
Yes, sir. I like to think here we like to look at individuals. We're not the Democrats. We don't think in groupthink. We think in individual. We need to look at each race as an individual race to judge each individual person, not a slate. That is what the Democrats would do. That is not what the GOP and liberty-minded people would do. I would like to speak against that. Thank you.
Thank you. Number two.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
This is wrong, wrong, wrong. There are many of us who want to run for office. If you do not allow us to run for office individually, this is a chilling effect. You're going to have nothing but a star chamber, which is what your nominating committee is. We want to be heard from the floor.
Okay. Number four.
Mr. Chairman, Rick Davies, Chairman of Cherokee County. According to the rules that we appear to have adopted, we have in rule number 8, no cumulative voting shall be allowed, a majority shall be required for election. In the event no candidate receives a majority on the first ballot, we need to have an individual ballot for every office. Thank you.
Thank you. Number 5.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I'd like to thank the nominating committee for the work they've done. However, I rise against this motion because I believe it goes against what Republicans believe in, or at least what grassroots Republicans believe in fairness, honesty, and integrity.
Chair, let me work my way back. So all I'm going to do, until we finish this discussion, is just go 1 through 5, and then once we're done, then we'll call the question, I assume, at some point. Number one.
Thank you, Mr. Evans. Mike Francis from Cobb County, and I also rise to speak against this motion. We have many people here who have stated an interest in running for the leadership of this party. I think trying to have all these races combined into one slate would deny a lot of people the opportunity to speak to this body about how they would lead us in the future, which I believe is the main reason that we're here, is to have a direction in the leadership of this party. I would further ask if the original mover of this motion could withdraw the motion. I believe that would be in all of our interest. Thank you.
Number two. Anybody had I'm sorry, number two.
Hello, Caleb Hornsby from Augusta, Richmond County. I would also like to thank the committee for taking their time and making the slate, but I would also like to recommend the body of this delegation to vote against the accepting of the slate so that we can have nominations and have everyone be able to participate. Thank you.
Number three, is there anybody in number three? No. Number four, yes.
I'm Roger Marble from Gwinnett County, and my wife's running for the treasurer position. She's spent, I don't know how many countless hours, how many countless meetings she's gone to, how much money we spent on this convention, and I believe that her voice should be heard. I'm a veteran, I serve my country, I know what the Republican Party is supposed to stand for, and this is not what it stands for. Vote against the motion.
Mr. Chairman, my name is Tony Dimitri from DeKalb County. I am against having vote by snake. This is mafia style. We need to have individual offices. We might like some of these people that nominated committee, right? We might not like some. So I would like to have each office individual and give an opportunity for everybody in this convention to come forward. We might like this guy from this group, we might like this guy from another group. We might like to have a group or officers from one from each county to make it balanced. Besides, none of these people were sitting in this nominating commission. We don't know anything about them. We don't know what they were talking about. We don't know even they were cooking the books. So this is mafia style.
Number one.
Mr. Chairman, I'm Todd Crowder, delegate from Cobb County. I'm a professional registered parliamentarian. I point out that on page 432, after the nominating committee report, should be nominations from the floor. To take a motion that does something else is tantamount to a suspension of the rules and would require a two-thirds vote. Thank you.
Let's see, there's nobody at number two, nobody at number three, number four.
Mr. Russell Steen from DeKalb County. If you look at the rules which were passed out, which we voted on, the last part of rule number six says we will vote by officer. This is against the rules and would a minimum require a two-thirds vote to suspend the rules to even consider this motion. It's out of order.
Number five.
Mr. Chairman, Senator Mike Crane from the glorious 28th District.
Number five, you by far have the most sensitive mic, so just, you can, there we go, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If it be in order, I'd like to make a motion to table the previous motion and move on.
So we have a motion to table. Okay, there's a motion to table. Is there a second? Okay. So a motion to table and a second. And so I'm going to, so first of all, is there any debate on the motion to table? Hold on. Is there any, be more specific here, is there any point of parliamentary inquiry or point of order on the motion to table? Yes.
I believe the motion to table
Number three.
I believe a motion to table can only be presented when there's more pressing business that must be attended. You cannot table a motion just because you don't like it.
Right. Okay. Is there any other point of order or point of parliamentary inquiry? Yes.
Point of parliamentary inquiry, if we do table it, that means that we have to come back to it anyway, right?
That is correct.
Okay.
That means I would take nominations from the floor, and then I would have to come back to the motion to elect by slate. So does everybody understand what would have to happen? No? Okay, let me put it this way. So if I don't grant anything, all I do is try to follow the rules here. If you decide to table the motion to elect, what would then happen is I would accept nominations from the floor. Once all of the nominations were closed, I would then revisit the motion to elect by slate. In which case, you could then vote yea or nay. And so the question is, do you want to vote on it now, or do you want to vote on it later? Okay. So if you want to vote on it now, stand up. Table. Okay, please sit down. If you want to vote on it later, please stand up. Yes, number five.
Yes, I'd just like for you to make a clarification on what we're voting on.
Sure. The clarification is on whether we vote on the motion to elect by slate now, or do we vote on the motion to elect by slate later? Having just taken the vote, it's overwhelmingly the motion is to take the vote now, Hey guys. So just so we're clear, if you want to vote on the motion now, please stand. If you want to vote on the motion to elect by slate now, you just want to vote on it, get it out of the way, stand. It's overwhelming. Please sit down. So the motion to table is defeated. So is there any other motion, any other debate on the main motion, which is the motion to elect by slate? Yes, number three.
Mr. Chairman, this is Oscar Persons. I'm from Fulton County. I want to say that I am planning to vote for every person who is on the nominating committee slate. However, I think that we should give all the other candidates who are here and campaigning a chance to be heard and to have us stand up, vote for everyone that wants to do that. So I would urge that we vote against the motion to elect by slate. Thank you very much.
Is there any other discussion? Yes? I have a call of the questions. Is there a second? All those in favor say aye. Opposed, nay. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. The question has been called. We will now vote on the motion to elect by slate. Yes, we have a number four.
I raised a point of order, and the chairman never ruled on that point. I would like a ruling, please, Mr. Chairman.
What is your point of order?
The original point of order several minutes ago that rules number six prohibit this vote.
I did rule on that, and I said that it did not operate to close nominations. Is there another point?
Thank you, sir. Wait. That rule had nothing to do with closing nominations. That was for voting by office. It's in the rules, rule number six. That was my point of order.
And I ruled that it did not. And so your point has been ruled on. Speaker five, Brant.
Just to be clear, Mr. Chairman, we're about to vote on whether or not to elect by slate.
Correct.
And so if the delegates here want to elect all their candidates, one all together as a batch, and they vote for electing by slate?
Yeah, they vote
But if they want to vote individually,
they vote
one
no.
at a time, we vote no.
Right.
So if we want to vote individually, friends, we vote no. If we want to vote as a slate, we vote yes.
Right.
Is that right?
That's exactly right. And I'll come to that again. Anything else? Yes, sir. Number one.
Chairman, point of information. Have we passed any actual convention rules? Or are we still operating under Robert's Rules of Order?
Yes, we are.
And the second thing, point of order, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Then under Robert's Rules, it originally states that individuals must be elected individually. Anything that changes that is a two-thirds vote. I request a ruling on that.
The ruling on the chair is that it does not say what you just said. It says that you cannot close nominations. So that's the difference. So we're ready to vote. Okay? So here's very simple, and I think Grant put it well. If you vote yes, then we will vote by slate. Everybody understand? It means everybody at one time. If you vote no, then we'll hear from the various candidates who want to run individually. Does everybody understand? Anybody not understand what we're voting on? So if you want to vote and elect by slate, please stand up. Okay. If you want to hear take nomination from the floor and vote individually, please stand up. Now, please sit down. Now, all I have to say to you, to those of you who want to debate the Robert's Rules of Order with me, having done this for some 35 years, the system actually does work. We just have to let the system work. And this is about following the rules and then casting votes and let the will of the convention be heard. So let's, if we can do that, then we'll be good. So let's take nominations from the floor. If you have a nomination from the floor, all you need to do first is go to a microphone, and then I'm gonna start and work my way across. As you can tell, there is no reason to panic that somehow you're not gonna get your chance. So is everybody ready? So I don't see anybody at number one, so I'm gonna go to number two. Hold on, I gotta get my pen out. All right, number two.
I nominate John Ferris for secretary.
For John. And it is John. F-E-R-R-O-S, for secretary. Are there other nominations? Number two.
I nominate Nate Porter for second vice chair.
Nate? What spell last name?
Porter.
P-O-R-T-E-R.
Porter.
All right. Because in case you can't tell, up here we get the echo. Out there, well, you may get the echo out there too, so. Number three.
Mr. Chairman, I'm Nancy Sellers of Gwinnett County. I nominate Mike Cavazos for assistant treasurer.
Spell the last name for me.
K-O-V-I-C-H.
Okay, is anybody else at number three? Number four.
Terry Green, I nominate Alex Johnson for state GOP chairman.
Okay, and number five.
Chairman,
yes.
Counsel kind of left the barn already, but wouldn't it seem to be reasonable that we nominate by office and in order instead of kind of randomly as they come to our minds?
I have been scolded rather prominently about the Robert's Rules prohibiting me from closing nominations prematurely, so I am going to take all the nominations. And so, if anybody has a nomination,
as a follow-on, Mr. Chairman. Would it be out of order to make a motion that we elect by office in some order, top to bottom to top?
Once the nominations are closed, we will take them in the order in which they were presented by the chair.
Thank you, sir.
You absolutely. Who's next? Okay, number one.
Mike Francis, and I would like to nominate Brittany Marmol for treasurer.
Spell last name.
M-A-R-M-O-L.
Okay. Anybody? Is there somebody else? Or any other nominations? Okay, here we go, number two.
Point of information. Are all of the nominees from the slate presently nominated?
What is it? Yeah, the nominations committee report operates as a nomination. Yes. Number one, I'm sorry, it's my fault.
Catherine McCann, Lamar County. I would like to nominate Monica Walters for Assistant Secretary.
Monica Walters?
Yes, sir.
Walters. All right. Any other nominations? Any other nominations? Yes, I'm sorry. Number five.
Yes, sir. I'd like to nominate Jesse Sargent for First Vice Chair.
Say, I'm sorry, I lost it.
Jesse Sargent for First Vice Chair.
Jesse Sargent.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, any other nominations? Any other? Yes, number five.
Yes, Mary, I'm sorry. Nominate Mary Kay Bacalow for Assistant Secretary.
Mary Kay, spell the last name.
Mary Kay.
Yeah, I got that part. I know I graduated from Georgia, but I got the Mary Kay.
Mary Kay, come to the microphone. She ran for state school superintendent.
I believe you. I just need the spelling of her last name.
That's why I'm asking her to come spell it for me.
Well, if you can't spell it, how am I supposed to spell it?
Mamma mia, B-E-A-T-A.
One second. Wait a minute. She's got right here. Okay, I have it. From the secretary gave it to me. Yes, you're welcome.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, point of order.
Yes.
Can you be kind and read the names you have on the list which was prepared by the nomination committee, because we're sitting here in the dark.
I will. I'll be happy.
Please do.
Yeah, I will treat that as a point of inquiry.
Thank you, sir.
Absolutely. And the chairman, John Padgett, First Vice Chair Michael McNeely, Second Vice Chair Debbie McCord, Treasurer Mansell McCord, Assistant Treasurer John Wallace, Secretary Kirk Shook, Assistant Secretary Layla Shipman. Okay, is there any other nominations? Any other nominations? I have a motion nomination be closed. Is there a second? Four? Hold on. Go ahead, number four.
I was just about to move the nominations be closed, but I second that motion.
I know. They trust us not, and yet so far everybody gets to hear. So I have a motion that the nominations be closed. Is there a second? All those in favor say aye. All those opposed say nay. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, the nominations are closed. All right, so what we do under the rules, yes, sir? Go ahead. You don't have to run. Because I don't, as number two, being the lawyer, one of the lawyers in the room, seeing you run across courts makes me nervous. Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, Dan Galloway from Cobb County. Since the rules that we approved did not actually say that we should conduct the elections as you described using the ballots given, I move that we do so for all the positions for the state executive.
I don't think we need it, but let's just do it for putting on our belt and safety pants. So, is there a motion? Is there a second? All those in favor of using the ballots, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say nay. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. These are the ballots. Okay, rule seven, convention rules. You got your convention rules handy? In the event more than one candidate is nominated for the office of state chairman, each will be allocated a total of 5 minutes to be divided as the candidate wishes between nominating speeches and or an address to the convention. So I would ask John Padgett and Alex Johnson to please come forward to split up your 5 minutes however you would like. I do need a timekeeper. Who here can keep time? Gordon, you got a second watch? Oh, I'll use the U.S. Navy veteran here I trust him on time. He's randomly selected from the audience. So come on up. I ask the two candidates to come forward with whoever's going to speak with you. I'm going to trust Gordon Austin. Gordon, stand up so everybody knows who you are. Turn around. This is the Navy. He taught me, by the way, in the Navy, they have a thing called the one-handed clap. Is that what it's called? Oh, the one clap, which is to cut down the length of applause. That's their whole clap. I taught them we could use that in the U.S. Congress pretty well. That's right. So, hold on. Let me go check to see if we have our candidates and see if they're ready. attention. We're about to start. Yes, sir. Yeah, number three.
Point of inquiry.
Yes.
For the interest of expediency, would it be possible to bring up all of the nominees so they're all in the back? So
yeah.
You have to call them.
That's
up.
A great suggestion. If you are a nominee or going to help a nominee, would you please come on behind the curtain so you can be organized? So, great suggestion. However, I have been posed with a question which is actually your decision, not mine. The candidates have raised the question of whether it is supposed to be for chairman 5 minutes or 10 minutes. The rules say five. I don't see a motion to change it to 10, so we're going to stick with five. Is that good? All right, John Padgett.
Hi, I'm Jack Kingston. I want to say I'm very proud to be here. I'm proud to be a Republican. This is not my first convention, and it won't be my last one, because just like you, I care. I'm here because I want to be here, just as you are here. Now, in Savannah, St. Patrick's Day every year, the entire town is Irish. I'd like to say, when it comes to Republican conventions, we're all Scotch-Irish, meaning independent, fiercely competitive, stubborn as a mule. And yet we have to take those tenets, those characteristics, away from this convention hall today, no matter what happens, no matter what team you are on, and go out and fight the Democrats and take back the United States of America. Is the most important thing. I'm here for my Athenian friend, John Padgett. John is a businessman. John knows how to run things. Under John's leadership, we had 17 offices across the state of Georgia. Under John's leadership, we were able to retain the governorship, the U.S. Senate, pick up a congressional seat, and keep the entire state legislators and Republicans from the courthouse to the Capitol Hill, all intact. He raised $6.5 million to do that. John can walk in to the big donors who aren't likely to always be here today, but he can walk into their offices and say, I need a check, not a $1,000 check, but a $15,000 and a $20,000 check. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me say this. We've got great candidates for all these offices. I'm proud to be here on behalf of John Padgett. I hope you will look at his record and his results and return him to be our state party chairman. Thank you.
Look, folks, I've had this job for 2 years. It's been an absolute distinct honor to work with you. I intend to be back to work with you again, whether I'm the chairman or not. You can't run me off. I'll be a Republican until you put me in that box. I hope it's not in the same box where all my guns are, but until then, we've had a great run. We won everything we could win in last year's election. Because of you, because of the plan this party put together, and to be candid with you, because of my leadership. And I thought we had a great time, and I thought we did great things. I am a businessman. Worked for myself all these different years, still working for myself. I've worked in my community, I've worked in my political party. But the most important thing that I am is a daddy and a granddaddy and a husband. And regardless of this today, I'll still be that. Whether you think I did a good job or not, whether you decide whether you want me back as your chairman, my family thinks I'm great. And I got a new little 2-year-old grandbaby in Arizona. She thinks big guy's the best. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your vote. I hope you have me back. I enjoyed being part of your team. and I look forward to working with you in the future. Thank you, and God bless you.
Needs help. Alex has been open to listening. One of the things that impresses me most about Alex is that no matter what is said about him, he stays above the fray. In all of my time in talking to him, I have witnessed something in him that is rare that you don't see in those who are older. He doesn't snap back with a curt word about anybody that's speaking ill of him. And that is a quality in him that it is rare in today's political world. Alex's beliefs are conservative. He stands for life, marriage, Israel, and family values that have made America great. His values are right. His vision is bright. I am willing to trust him with our state party future. I hope that you will join me in voting for Alex Johnson. God bless you, and God bless America.
Hi, my name is Kay Godwin. I have 27 years put my life into the Republican Party, and I want to tell you that I have never been as enthusiastic about casting my vote as I am for Alex Johnson. Thank you.
My name is Bob Mazes. 22 years ago, I attended my first convention. 2 years later, I became the treasurer of the Georgia Republican Party. Today, I stand before you as simply a delegate, as a retired treasurer. In that time, I've served with many chairmen and many EDs, and I believe now it's time for a change. I rise to speak on behalf of Alex Johnson. I met him years ago, but I really only got to know him in the last couple of months. I believe that he has the integrity to do the job, and more than anything else, I think he has the heart, the passion, and the energy, and the willingness to listen to others. I would like for you to consider voting for Mr. Alex Johnson. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Senator Mike Crane from the 28th District, and the future of the Republican Party is at stake today. The future of the Republican Party is a party that will not only pass resolutions like we did today, but they will vote for resolutions like we did today. The future of the Republican Party will not only stand for religious liberty, they will quit explaining for religious freedom, they will quit cowering behind those corporate giants that say you can't have it. The Republican Party, the future of the Republican Party is on this stage today. His name is Alex Johnson. I give him my strongest endorsement. Welcome, Alex Johnson.
Thank you. Thank you, Kay, Senator Crane, Bob Mazes, for the kind introduction, and Bob for his honesty, integrity, and service to the party. Ever since I became involved in the Republican Party back in 2003, I did so because I believed, as I do now, in the values that Terry stated: limited government, local control, pro-life, traditional family values, and the Constitution. I believe that by being involved, that I could make a difference in ensuring that our principles and our platform were enacted into law, and just like many of you have. Yet that isn't happening. We often feel betrayed when candidates we supported vote for bigger and more expansive government and vote against bills supporting our platform. Then we are dismayed when people become frustrated and leave the party, taking their time and money elsewhere. Enough is enough. It's time for a change. I am asking for your vote today because it is time for new leadership that will stand up for you and your principles. New leadership that will stand up for the truth. even if it may anger those who prefer political favoritism over principled leadership. New leadership that will listen to and stand up for all of you in this hall and throughout the state. It is not time to be complacent with the way things are. It is time for the Georgia GOP to not only think about the immediate past or future election, but to focus efforts on unifying this party and growing a grassroots infrastructure that will ensure Republican victories for decades into the future. That is why I have a team of energetic, experienced, and engaged members of the party, some with much more experience than myself, that are prepared to work tirelessly on your behalf to advance our party and its principles. We will hold events throughout the state, not just in Atlanta, to raise involvement and funds, as well as to educate the public on how our platform and our principles help people's lives, because that is the only way we grow this party. We will institute competitive bidding for services to ensure that donor money is put to good use. Thank you all very much. I appreciate your vote and support.
Thank you. Okay, ready to vote? Take out your booklets. Everybody get your booklet in your hand. Now, one question I got was, it says delegate name and cell number. Do not turn that in. That is just in case you lost your booklet. Oh, see, there's a perforation there. You're gonna tear off right in front of it. Number two, I think I had a point of parliamentary inquiry for the delegate strength. I have called the Credentials Committee back to give us that number. Remember, the election is decided by the number, a majority of the numbers cast, not of a majority of the numbers eligible. So, but I want to go ahead. I said I'd get that number. I want to give you the number.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, I appreciate your patience to allow the Credentials Committee to be diligent with our report. We do have the final convention voting strength for you. That number is 1513. That's 1,513, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, so take your booklet, tear along the perforation. Could tear with me. See that? Number one. I know. Number one. Tear number one off. Hold it up and let me see that you have it. If you want to vote for John Padgett, you will mark the number one. If you want to vote for Alex Johnson, you will mark the number 10. And see at the very top, there's the little numbers, 1 through 10. So if you want to vote for John Padgett, you mark the number one. If you want to vote for Alex Johnson, you mark the number 10. Is everybody clear? Now, once you have voted, just fold it down the middle. Oh. If you want to fold it, fold it. If you don't worry about that. And then just pass it down the row, and the sergeant-at-arms will collect them. You see them? You can go either way. If you notice right here, in section 3, we have somebody just collecting them. And I will make sure before I stop that everybody's ballot has gotten in the hands of a sergeant-at-arms. Credentials Committee, please do not collect ballots. Credentials Committee, please do not collect ballots. Only Sergeant at Arms are collecting ballots. If you have a ballot, yes? Go to a microphone for me. Number one.
Mr. Chairman,
yes?
Point of information.
Sure.
If we are undecided, turning in a blank ballot will be counted and it will allow for maybe someone not to get 50%. Is that correct?
It's 50% of the cast ballots.
I know.
All right. McNeely and Jesse Sargent and your teams meet me right here so that I can work while you work.
Candidates available to observe the county, yes. Because I remember there was a ruthless leader who made a statement whose name was Stalin. Stalin said, I don't care who votes, as long as I can count them.
Well, okay? if you look at the end of Rule 7, each candidate may have a representative present during the tabulation process. So, anybody else got a ballot on that has not been collected? Anybody else? Okay, we're about to move to first vice chair. All right, for first vice chair, each gets 2 minutes. Each gets 2 minutes. And the first will be Michael McNeely.
Good evening, delegates. My name is Michael McNeely, and I'm currently your first vice chairman. I remember several years ago when I went into my first county meeting, didn't know a soul, no one knew me. I was the only minority in the room, but it didn't matter because I had a set of beliefs. I believed the conservative principles of the Republican Party, and I went to the meeting with the party that held those beliefs. And I've been serving in this party ever since. And in serving as first vice chair, just like in anything we do, we must produce fruit. Scripture talks about judging people by their fruit. And so I just want to share a little bit about what I've done in working with you to help grow our party. I talked about 2 years ago that people don't care how much you know until they know how much you can. And as a result, The Community Service Committee was created, and I've been working with some great folks from around the state to help do a lot of great things. We raised over $7,000 in the midst of an election cycle when we were working on it, electing Republicans all around the state, over $7,000 to help sick children that are coming to Atlanta to get treatment for cancer all across the state. We've been working with Veterans Empowerment Organization to help homeless veterans not only get housing,
but get clothes and suits to go out on job interviews, to sign up for benefits, doing all that amidst electing Republicans, because we do care about people. And it's important that we as a party show that against what Democrats and the traditional media say about us.
How's this gonna go?
I've had the opportunity to serve with minority engagement, going all around the state with the minority engagement team to talk to black pastors all across the state to talk about our conservative principles. We had Governor Deal come to my church and talk to the people, and he got a standing ovation based on principles. And those principles win today. So those are just a few examples, but I'm here to serve with you. And we have a lot more work to do. So I ask you today to please vote for me to continue to serve you as your first vice chair. Thank you.
My name is Derek Grayson, and I'm here to introduce Jesse Sargent. Before he comes up, I want to say a couple of things. Our party boasts that we won a whole bunch of Republican offices. But when I end up with a tax hike, extra hotel fees, and have to pay money for electric vehicles, that's not a win for me. You almost lost your ability to vote by individuals through a slate. Haven't you had enough of people taking away your voice by thinking they know what's best for you? Well, Jesse Sargent represents new blood. Why do we like babies so much? Because they're brand new, untainted, unbought, unbossed. Let's get some new blood in this house and turn this thing around. Jesse Sargent, new blood.
My name is Jesse Sargent. I appreciate y'all's consideration. I'm running for first vice chairman, I guess you know. I tried to congratulate my opponent earlier, just a minute ago. He snubbed me, and I don't think that's very good. Yeah, I'm not joking. I don't believe that's how you bring new people into the Republican Party. You do not treat them that way. You don't treat them the way that the Republican Party has treated some people. Not all of you, I'm not saying that, but you don't treat people that way. If you want to bring young people into the Republican Party. I'm a veteran of Operation Iraqi Freedom. What have I done for the Republican Party? Why would we trade what I've done for my country for that? What I've done for the Republican Party is I've recruited people for the Republican Party to be delegates, and I've sent them here. And some of them have been treated very horribly, and those are my friends. Where are they? They're not even here anymore. I want to see change in the Republican Party that reflects our conservative values. And that's being gracious with people. I appreciate your consideration. Vote Jesse Sargent, first vice chairman. Thank you.
Okay, so at this moment we have a decision to make. My sergeant at arms are gonna be counting ballots. So I can't take ballots on this race. We can either take a recess till they finish, or we can hear from the next set of candidates so that we can do work. So is there a motion that we proceed with the speeches but not the voting? Is there a second? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. The ayes have it, so we'll now hear from, let's see, I need Debbie McCord and Nate Porter's teams to meet me right here. Yeah, go to a microphone. Just one last call for ballots. Anybody who didn't turn in your ballot, right now is your last chance. I think I've asked for them about four times. Anybody else? No, I think we're good. Debbie McCord.
Good afternoon. Thank you. But I only have 2 minutes. First of all, let me thank you all for giving up have a beautiful weekend. Many of you have been here since Thursday, most of you since Friday, and then all day today. If you're like me, you work for a living, so Friday was a vacation day. Thank you for taking the time away from your family, your jobs, and being here to do the work of the party. I have been actively involved with the Georgia Republican Party since I moved back to Georgia in the late 1980s. Really started going to state conventions in 1990. I have been privileged to serve for the past 4 years, two as your assistant secretary, and the last two as your secretary of the Georgia Republican Party. We have had a great run of success, but we don't get to sit on our laurels. We've got to continue building our grassroots network in Georgia to get ready for 2016. That includes increased focus on minority engagement, increased training with our local parties to aid them in recruitment, and increased outreach to candidates and recruiting candidates in smaller areas where it is traditionally they vote nationally Republican, but they vote Democrat at the local level. We've got to start looking for those county commission candidates, those courthouse candidates, those sheriff's candidates who are willing to put the Republican behind their name. And that's what I want to focus, because that helps us build a lasting, enduring grassroots network. I greatly appreciate your time today, and I would greatly appreciate your vote for second vice chair. Thank you.
Hey there. For those of you guys that don't know me, my name is Nate Porter, and I'm running for the second vice chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. Just a little bit of a background on me. I'm 34 years old. My wife and I started a business here. We own two businesses that we've built from the ground up in Roswell, Georgia. We have 10 employees. We are bookkeepers. We do payroll business. We have over 200 clients in over 40 different states. As far as my political experience goes, I started out in the Republican Party in the state of Washington when I was actually in college, where I actually worked a lot on Senate campaigns, congressional campaigns, along with the presidential campaigns while I was in college. I was involved heavily in the Michigan State GOP as well, and then when I moved to Georgia, that's when I finally became involved in the actual party here that we're at today. I'm involved in the Fulton County Republican Party, where I'm their web guy. I'm one of their chairmen as far as the precinct areas go, and I help out with the membership committee in trying to bring new members in. And one of the reasons why I'm running right now more than anything else is I come to these events and I constantly hear lip service paid to minority engagement or to raising funds or to any of the other things that we talk about. So what I'm trying to do is, instead of talking about it, I actually want to take action. So I'm currently working with members of this party, John Farrows, Dallas Hamilton, and other Hispanic members to create the Republican National Hispanic Assembly of Georgia here locally. Es muy importante amentuar la representación de los hispanos en el Partido Republicano. It's very important that we actually get Hispanics involved in the Republican Party, because they are a natural fit with our demographic. So it's really, really important that we actually reach out to them, and we reach out to them where they're at and not expect them to come to us. Beyond just the minority engagement though, we need to raise funds. And just saying that isn't magically gonna make them come in. So I'm actually working with different Republican county parties and different Republican organizations to put together a specific fundraiser that's also designed to help increase awareness to the Second Amendment. I'd appreciate your vote. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, 1 second. Somebody took my list of... Any of it. Come back to it in a second. I had a working list of candidates laying here, but I think one of our speakers took it with them, so I'll have to double check on that. Here it is, right here. Microphone three.
Mr. Chairman, I rise to request that, other than the election for chairman, the rest of the elections be held by a standing vote. I make the motion we have a standing vote in order to move things along.
So, the ruling of the chair is that having taken a motion to hear from all the speakers, it's untimely, but I will revisit that motion once the speeches have been completed.
Okay? Right, thank you.
Next is Treasurer, Mansell McCord and Brittany Marmol. Yeah. What? Yeah, that might be. Well, hold on. Let me get five first. Five?
Mr. Chairman, how are we supposed to remember who's running for what? We go through this whole group of people. Can we, for each office, can we put the candidates as when they speak or finish speaking on the screen so that we know what we're doing?
Well, what I would do is I'd bring them back up before we vote so that you can see them again. So that way you'll see them. I don't want anybody to, hopefully they leave a lasting impression and it's unforgettable, but if not, then I will certainly bring them back up. Microphone number one.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, instead of having the Sergeant-at-Arms collect these votes and then them being off-counting, why don't we have boxes we can drop these in and then we can move on, we can vote, get the next, collect the votes. I mean, it's just a thought.
No, that was probably a pretty good idea, but unfortunately, we're in the middle of the river now, so it's kind of hard to change votes.
Well, I tried to tell you before, you can look over here.
Yeah. All right, so we have Treasurer Mansell McCord and Brittany Marmol. Hold on.
Good afternoon, I'm Josh McCoon. I'm here today to tell you, to be treasurer of the Georgia Republican Party, you need a man of unimpeachable integrity. You need someone that understands the complexity of campaign finance law, and you need someone who's been dedicated to the conservative movement for decades. That person is Mansell McCord. He is my good friend. I'm proud to call him my friend, and you will be proud to call him the next treasurer of the Georgia Republican Party.
Thank you, Josh. My name is Mansell McCord. I'm from Fulton County, and I am seeking election as your next state treasurer. You have a card on your chair that has my biography and what my experience is. I won't belabor any of that, and I entrust that to you for you to consider. I believe that I have the background and the experience to serve as your next treasurer, but more importantly, I have a record of proven leadership. Professionally, I'm a small business attorney. I provide legal and business advice to small businesses with a combined annual revenue in the millions of dollars. But I have a record of leadership. My third year of law school, when I still lived in Mississippi, I was concerned because our area of the state was underrepresented in the legislature, and I took a semester off and undertook to run for the state house. And I was the only Republican candidate in the entire congressional district in either house of the legislature. And earlier this week in a special election, that district now voted over 80% Republican. In 2010, when the leadership program in Georgia that was started by Senator Coverdell was in danger of going away, I stepped forward and provided the leadership for that program to continue and have served for the last 6 years as its executive director. And we have elected five new conservative members of the legislature over those 5 years. I humbly, respectfully ask for your vote and support as your next state party treasurer. Thank you.
Ready, go right ahead.
I'm here and I'm honored to be here introducing this young lady. Something that we need in our party. Someone with the experience. She's been the treasurer of Gwinnett County 2 years and just got reelected. She is a CPA and runs the accounting and CPA stuff at Oglethorpe University, a $40 million budget. We need young people, we need women in our party. I ask everyone that has supported me through the years and every one of the women that have supported me to vote for Brittany. Here she is, Brittany Marmo.
Thank you, Ron. Hello, my fellow Republicans. Again, my name is Brittany Marmo. I am a CPA and I have broad experience in accounting. I've served as the Gwinnett County Treasurer and I've headed the Budget Committee there. I've made hundreds of phone calls and knocked on thousands of doors for Republican candidates. I've traveled to many counties this past month and discussed with many wonderful individuals the message of fiscal conservatism, limited government, and how the Republican Party plays a part upon this message. Historically, the Republican Party is the party of the people. It was the Republican Party that drafted the Emancipation Proclamation. It was the Republican women who drafted the 19th Amendment and a Republican Congress who voted in favor of universal women's suffrage. The first woman elected to the House of Representatives was a Republican. The first Asian American senator was a Republican. And the first African American congressman and senator were a Republican. Whether you're a fiscal conservative Republican, a social conservative Republican, a Tea Party Republican, a Liberty Republican, or a traditional Republican, we all must stand united. We must all unite as one and stand for the principles of liberty, freedom, and justice for all. Now, these are more than words. These are the perspectives. And I thank you for taking the time. Thank you.
Now, to quote my grandmother, I don't want you to think that when I stand up here that I've just got ants in my pants. I'm actually responding to the timekeeper. I find that it's not good to actually move them off the stage, but I do want to provide a visual alert that, in fact, we have reached the end of the 2 minutes. So I just wanted an explanation. Next is Assistant Treasurer John Wallace and Mike Cobra.
Thank you, Randy. My name is John Wallace. I'm from Cherokee County, and I'm seeking the office of Assistant Treasurer. A long time ago, in a far-off place, I graduated with a degree in accounting and a minor in political science. And throughout my life, my vocation has always been taking many areas of corporate life, accounting, auditor, trainer, statistician, engineer, salesman, congressional staff. And my avocation has always been public policy and campaigns. In 1997-98, I was in the second class of the Coverdell Leadership Institute. On the county party level, I've been vice chairman of fundraising 3 times, vice chairman for candidates, elected officials 3 times, and I've been on the county, district, state executive committees. I've also been the 11th district chairman in 2011-2013. In the campaign area, I have been involved in over 50 campaigns from county, district, state, and national level, including Sam Olens' run for Attorney General 5 years ago. I was his grassroots director for Georgia. And over 30 years ago, I was the first district leader in the state of Kentucky for a little-known county judge from Jefferson County called Mitch McConnell. I have been a hardworking Republican party builder for decades in 2 states, and I plan to continue that work with your help. Please elect John Wallace, Assistant Treasurer. Thank you.
Good afternoon, or is it evening yet? My name is Mike Kovacic, and I'm running to be your Assistant Treasurer. First, I want to take just a second to thank each and every one of you, because I know not only are you giving up this Saturday, but you gave up your time in your mass meetings and your county conventions and the whole path of your way here. And as a former county party chairman, I know exactly how much time that is, and I not only appreciate it, I salute you, because you're the reason that we have the success that we do, so thank you. I graduated from the accounting school right over the hill here, and 22 years on, I've been a CPA in public and private practice, working with businesses in all stages of growth and development, from large into small, and the success in all of that is watching things grow and being a part of that. And I cherish the part that I've been a part of both business world and this party world. And I look forward to your support. I was a young Republican chairman when we first elected George W. Bush. I was the county party chairman when we reelected him. And I would like to be your assistant treasurer when we elect the next Republican president. Thank you.
Secretary is Kirk Shook and John Farrows. Kirk, are you there?
Good afternoon. My name is Miriam Shook, and my husband Kirk is running for Georgia GOP Secretary. And today I want to tell you a little bit about him. 2 years ago, you elected Kirk as the Assistant Secretary of the State Party. We have traveled all over the state for the past 2 years, traveling thousands of miles, meeting you, forming friendships, and it's been fun, and it's great to see all of your friendly, familiar faces today. Kirk has been involved with the Republican Party since he was 16. It was actually the Republican Party that brought us together in 2010 when we met at a campaign cookout. Since we've been together, we've enjoyed being actively involved together at the grassroots level in the Oglethorpe County GOP, the 10th District, and the Georgia GOP. From our getting to know some of you, you may have noticed that Kirk is very passionate about the Republican Party. He is a Christian first, and his faith guides every decision that he makes. Kirk is kind, compassionate, fair, and has a huge heart. He teaches Sunday school, sings in our church choir, is a deacon, and is my biggest cheerleader. My husband is young and driven, and he wants to see the conservative Republican Party principles further for future generations. It is my joy to introduce you to my husband, Kirk Shook.
I don't think I can top that. That's why I asked her to do that. I do appreciate your support last time when I ran for Assistant Secretary. I've thoroughly enjoyed the job. I hope that I can earn your vote for Secretary. I've been working around the state, as she said, and I've gone from chairman and district officer all the way to the state officers. I hope I can earn your vote one more time. Thank you so much. It's time once again to get all shook up for Shook. Remember that.
Assistant Secretary, we have Layla Shipman, Monica Walters, and Mary Kay Acabo. I know I'm going to butcher that last name. Back out. My bad. John Farrows. John, this is for Secretary against Kirk Shook.
Dear fellow Republicans, my name is John Farrows, and I'm running for Secretary. Why do I wish to serve as your Secretary? Simply put, we can do better. I served as the Fulton County GOP Secretary from 2013 to 2015. During that period of time, do you know how many times I've heard from the state GOP secretary or other state leadership? Exactly zero. My vision for secretary is to reach out to all secretaries throughout the state. I will form a secretary's council. This council will provide training to secretaries at the county level so they can understand their responsibilities and duties. It will provide training with Robert's Rules of Order, to see how important that is today. We want to make sure that our meetings are run properly throughout the state. I'll work with the chairman to initiate a better way to run our mass meetings. This 1950s mentality of capturing information manually on paper, it's got to go. Now let's discuss some leadership. My friends, we have a momentous date before us in November of 2016. The state of Georgia will be instrumental in this election. It's no secret that Georgia is becoming more purple each day. Our Republican majority is at risk. The question for you, my friends, is who will lead the fight? Who will lead the grassroots to deliver this state into the Republican column come election day? The state is changing demographically. We need leadership that's able to reach out to that changing demographic. Leadership that's fresh, dynamic, not the same old thing. How do we reach out to young voters, voters of color, voters of Hispanic background? Recently, Reince Priebus, our RNC chair, said that we Republicans should learn to speak Spanish. ¿Quién es un republicano? Un republicano es una persona que vive su vida y vota en una manera semejante a los ideales de los republicanos. My friends, you can see I'm one of those Spanish-speaking Republicans. Lastly, we need leadership that will support real Republicans, keep our elected officials accountable, and accountable to that party platform. Someone who loves small government, low taxes, fidelity to the Constitution, and a lover of freedom and liberty. My name is John Ferris. I'm running for secretary, and I humbly ask for your vote. Thank you.
Assistant Secretary Layla Shipman, Monica Walters, and Mary Kay Bacchio.
I am very proud to stand before you today, along with my wife, Michelle, and the Fashes, Cameron and Nicole Fash, as well as our very good friend, Josh McCoon, to stand tall and to support Layla Shipman for the assistant secretary position. Layla is fantastic. You've heard a lot of people get up here and talk about what they have done in their careers or in the Republican Party. This is a person who her entire career, dating all the way back to high school, has been supporting this party. She is a two-term chairman of the Floyd County Republican Party. She actually started the Young Republicans up in Floyd County at a very early age, and she's just been reelected again. She was selected, along with Josh McCoon, as the National Young Republican of the Year for the entire United States. She is impressive. Thank you, please. I am so proud to stand before you today, along with our good friends, to support Layla Shipman, along with a lot of other folks around the state. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Layla Shipman. I'm running for Assistant Secretary. I've enjoyed campaigning the last 3 months all across the state. I appreciate every friend that I've had in all corners and all ends of the state that have supported my campaign. I may promise that I will make things easier as assistant secretary by using paper and pen and sometimes computers. Just mix it up a little bit and get crazy. Because the job is not a glamorous job. It's just to make sure that the secretary's backed up. So I am, and also if you guys were wondering who the girl was that fell on the bus, I've been told that I started off my weekend with a big bang. So this is the girl that fell on the bus, and I earned a few votes just for surviving that fall. But I get a little nervous speaking in public, and I just want to say thank you guys that have spoke for me when you guys know that I'm not very good at doing this part. Thank you.
Monica?
Good afternoon. My name is Bob Heine. I'm a Lamar County Commissioner for also a Republican for the last 40 years. And over those 40 years, I've seen a lot of people come and go, the Republican Party, some of which don't really work to promote and advance the principles of this great party, which is smaller government, lower taxes, less regulation. That's something I think we all want to see. And it's very important that we put people in position who will fearlessly and courageously advance those principles. So today, I would like to ask for you to consider voting for Monica Walters. I've known her for many years. She's not a Republican in name only. She's a true, right down to her DNA, believer in Republican principles. So I ask you please to vote for Monica Walters. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jerry Moore. I'm from Lamar County. This is only my second convention. I'm having a great time. I don't know about y'all. But I'd like to speak on behalf of a person who's been a friend for a number of years, a person with whom I've dealt with on numerous occasions, a person who is a good, strong member of our local Republican Party, a person who has served our community. When you see Monica, you'll see a person who is soft-spoken, who's laid back, but anyone who thinks she's soft is in for a rude awakening. She's a thinker. She's no stranger to logic and reason, two of those things that are no longer taught in our public schools today. And I can promise you that if you want to get something by Monica, you better be able to support it, because you're going to be in for a long and strong grilling on whatever it is that you're trying to get by. And I promise you, if you vote for Monica, you will not later come to regret that decision, because she's the person that will say what she thinks and then vote what she says. Thank you.
I had a lot to say to you, and I'm just going to have to ask for your vote. I will work hard as your assistant secretary. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, everybody. My name is Dr. Mary Kay Bacayao, and I started fighting Common Core about 4 years ago when I bought a ticket to the Columbus Republican Convention, and I told the governor, I said, Common Core is a can of worms. We need to get out of it. These past 4 years, I've been fighting it, and we're still in it. We just rebranded it. So I'm not gonna give up fighting Common Core. I'm a math teacher, and I know that it's not in the best interest of our state, our kids, to continue. We have a new school rating system called the CCRPI score, and it doesn't even rate reading ability. It just gives points, and the points are for things that the U.S. Department of Education wants. There are so many issues in education. As a teacher, I'm asking for you to vote for me for secretary, because if you would ask me to do anything to fight Common Core, I would bake cupcakes. I would. So I know this is not a speech about being against Common Core, but that's what brought me into politics. And as your assistant secretary, I'll make sure that the truth is told. I will always tell the truth. That's all I can promise. And I ask you to vote for me, Dr. Mary Kay Bacayao. Thank you.
Okay, you've heard from the various candidates, and I think now I have before me the motion by B.J. and Ben Gundy to take a standing vote on the ballots other than chair. Is there a second? Is there a discussion? Hearing none, then we'll proceed to a vote. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. You got to go to the microphone. Okay. So I'm going to start with one, then I'll do if there's two or three, and then I'll come to four. So one.
Don't you have to have the sergeant at arms to count for a vote?
Not for a standing vote, no. I mean, if we have to have a division of the House, then you are absolutely correct. Thank you. Other one.
Hi, my name is Janet Peters. I'm from Cobb County. And I believe that the secret ballot is the most important thing that we as Americans have a right to do. I would hate to say that we're going to do it otherwise because of a few more minutes that we have to take out of our lives for people who have given theirs to give us a secret ballot. This also came up in Cobb County, and I objected to it that time, and they did go to seek the ballots. I was happy for that. I would not want to see the state not do secret ballots when we have it arranged already. Thank you.
Next, one.
I'm Dr. Bill Hudson, and I think that we are not a union hall here, and we do not need to have standing ballots or voice ballots or anything else. We need to have a secret ballot. That was what this country was founded on. Thank you.
Next.
My name is Billy Dindy, and I'm from Cobb County. I was elected as a delegate to represent the people of Cobb County. I don't need to do a secret ballot. We need to let the people of Cobb County and the state know how we're voting in there for them, as we are elected delegates for that reason. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, number two.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
A standing vote is not the best way of doing this. If we have a secret ballot, it's the best way, because then you don't have to worry about your friends or neighbors looking at you and thinking something different about you. Quite frankly, you know what? When you go to the ballot box in November, do you have a standing vote, or do you vote secretly? There's a reason for that. It's the most American way, and it's a secret vote is the way we should go.
Number three.
From Fulton County, we have a perfectly good ballot. I would suggest that we use the ballot and vote on all of the positions, and then have them counted afterward. Those who want to stay for the final counts would be allowed to do so, and those who need to leave could leave.
Oscar?
Oscar.
Number three.
Sorry. Oscar Persons, Fulton County. I call the question, Mr. Chairman.
I'm going to come back to you, Oscar, but because I really want to let people have an opportunity to speak, I'll come back to that as soon as we've completed the round of the microphones. Daryl?
I totally believe in secret ballot when you are voting your individual preference, but as an elected delegate, as a representative for my county, we would not tolerate our congressional representatives holding secret ballots so we do not know how they voted. I feel that we should be willing to stand up and show the people who sent us here to represent them what our opinions are, and therefore I am totally in favor of doing a standing vote.
Number four.
I would like to remind the body that the convention rules state that each election shall be done by ballot individually. So in order to actually pass this motion to do it by standing vote, we would have to suspend that rule that would require two-thirds of the vote.
Number four.
Hi, I just wanted to say, if you are ashamed of who you're voting for and you're ashamed for people to know who you're voting for, maybe you should be voting for someone else.
Number four.
Yes, I would like for the body to know that this past Monday, the Georgia legislature elected a new majority leader by secret ballot in the Gold Dome this past Monday. So the argument that we are representing our delegates from our precincts or from our counties or our districts, just keep in mind that the Georgia legislature elected a new majority leader by secret ballot this past Monday.
Number five. Number
quick,
five.
Quick parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Is it true that we earlier voted to elect all officers by secret ballot? Is that correct?
No, that is not.
My mistake. Appreciate the clarification.
Thank you. Next, at five. Anybody else at five?
I guess I will. I came up and asked you something, and I don't know what you said. So would you just go look and see if my thing of tickets is in there with the election? I voted on the chairman, and they passed everything to me. And as far as I know, my little thing of tickets, so if I vote since the ballot, I can't vote anymore.
All right, I'll notify the sergeant at arms.
And if that's what you rule, that's okay with me. But I want you to find out if my ballots are back there.
All right,
and if you won't let me go look, then you go look.
Yes.
tempo when I ran. Go right ahead, number five.
Unfortunately, Mr. Chairman, the reason they have to vote in the House like they do for majority leaders or to lead the party is to keep from the others being intimidated from future punishment or rewards. And having been in a lot of these, I can say that's why most of us want a secret ballot, is to keep some of the other people from being intimidated. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Number five.
Catherine Bernard from DeKalb County. I would echo the sentiments of Mr. Painter. While we respect what Ms. Dindy is saying about the
I think everybody, we should all give each other respect. I mean, this is a very important thing that we do.
Well, I think it's
I'm going to come back to you. Because I just want to remind everybody, if we were in North Korea, we'd all be quiet because we'd have guns pointed. So here, this is the part of it that I enjoy and love the most. That's why I encourage debate constantly. And so I want to give respect to those who are speaking. So go right ahead, I'm sorry.
Okay. I'm Catherine Bernard from DeKalb County. I'm speaking in favor of secret ballots. I understand what Ms. Dindy is saying with that we are representatives of our districts, of our counties, of our mass precinct meetings. However, there is a lot of intimidation that does go on in these circumstances. So in order for us to accurately represent our mass precincts, our county conventions, we need to be able to vote without fear of retribution for the various positions that people are on. So we ask for a secret ballot.
All right, so I've worked my way back to one. One?
Oh. Sorry. My name is Emily Good. I'm from Cobb County, and I agree with Ms. Dindy. In addition to the fact that you're talking about the House electing their leaders, they chose to do it that way. They got a choice, so we should have a choice to vote whether or not we want secret ballot or not, and not just go with secret ballot. So this is what we're doing here. We're choosing. And also, if you are afraid to cast your vote, just remember all of the patriots that fought in the Revolutionary War that had to stand up against their families with fear of retribution. They didn't shrink down because of that. They still carried on. They learned how to work with the people that were opposed to them. And that's what we are, is one party. And whoever gets elected, we are to work with them whether we like them or not. And that's all I have to say.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I'm in favor of the standing vote because I think all of us need to exercise a little courage and not think that those who are going to win in an election would even have the thought of retribution. I think that we should not think of our fellow Republicans that way. I think we are magnanimous toward one another and that we can embrace competition in a very friendly way and then join together back in unity. And plus, I would also like for us to get to the resolutions and be able to vote on them. Thank you.
Number two. Number two, hold on. Try it now.
Thanks. Hello, I'm Mark Schumacher from Cobb County, and this may be a repeat of what Brandt had asked earlier, I'm not sure. But I'm curious, is this effectively just revisiting a motion already made? Because I remember when Don Galloway had raised his ballots asking, are we sure we're going to use every one of these ballots? And I believe you had made some belt and suspenders comment, and there was a unanimous vote. So this is doing the same thing, and I think there may, isn't there some issue about voting on the same thing you've already done before?
Okay, number two. I'm sorry?
That was an inquiry. Have we already voted on this?
We can vote on any issue as many times as we have a quorum. So, number two.
Diane Horgan, Fulton County. I've been doing this for decades. And the reality is it's not retribution as much as heart feelings. I don't think we have a single bad candidate. And it would be really good to have a secret ballot because
then whoever wins doesn't look askance at somebody who maybe voted for the other candidate, or maybe their supporters would. Once the vote is counted, that's our person. They are the best one because the majority chose them. And it doesn't matter whether it's a standing vote or a secret vote the same person selected, but the feelings of the other people might have been harmed. They may have been turned off for volunteering because of harsh looks. For unity, I recommend the secret ballot.
Number two. Who's that, Dave Baker?
Mr. Chairman, Dave Baker from Fulton County. I support the standing vote. We've already done a ballot for the chairman's race, and with all due respect to all the candidates who are running for very important positions, quite frankly, that's the most important one. In the interest of time, in the interest of being able to get to resolutions today, I support a standing vote here. I've stood for election statewide thanks to the many great people in this room. I trust that all the candidates who are running for office will be magnanimous enough to realize that we are all Republicans and will not hold grudges against our friends and neighbors who may not have voted for them, but will nonetheless support those who win. We're going to have over a dozen presidential candidates in this coming year. We're going to all support our candidates. We're going to get out and work hard. But at the end of it, we're going to come together as Republicans in unity supporting this party.
Thank you. So I'm going to treat the question as having been called on one and two, because I don't see anybody else. Number three? Number three? Go ahead.
That when you call for the vote, that you bring the candidates up on stage?
I will. I will do that.
That's all I ask.
Yeah, you're absolutely. Would not think of not having the candidates up whenever, so you can see who you're voting for. Senator McComb, good to see you. Always good to see you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to direct a comment. Earlier someone said, well, we could vote by secret ballot and then everyone could go home. I just wanted to make it very clear, the Resolutions Committee spent about 10 hours working on the resolutions that are still before this convention, and we all respect the work of the Resolutions Committee and give this convention an opportunity to hold elected Republicans accountable in this state. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else at number three? Then I will treat the question as having been called at number three. Number four?
Yes, sir. Trent Adams from Cherokee County. First of all, I've heard a lot that we need to be held accountable for how we vote today, and that seems to me to be a legitimate concern. However, if the only concern for the secret ballot is that it'll save time by doing a standing vote, this is one of the most important things that the party is going to be doing for the next 2 years. This is one of the most important days for party business. However long it takes to vote, however long it takes to do the resolutions, to discuss them thoroughly, and to get them out is very important. If you don't have time to do that today, why are you here? This event is for this business. If, however, the objection to secret ballots is that each person here needs to be accountable to how they vote, then I would move that the previous question be amended so that a roll call vote is counted for each delegate.
John?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to speak in favor of a standing vote. I've been a participant in this party for 20 plus years. I have voted against many, many people who did not win. I did not vote for the chairman the last election, and not a single time have I ever been made to feel inadequate or threatened or bullied by anybody. And I actually resent the implication by some that anyone that stands on that stage would do such a thing. I trust the leadership of this party. I trust the party, and I ask that we have a standing vote in the interest of time. It is 3:45 in the afternoon, and I would like to go home sometime before midnight. Thank you.
Aaron? We're almost there. We're almost to the call of question. Go ayahead, Marilyn.
Marilyn, this is a separate issue. I just want to clear something up. It's my understanding that Debbie McCord and Mansell McCord are not husband and wife. People are asking that question. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Go right ahead.
I can't top that, sorry. Jack Stanton from Cherokee County. I rose to spoke against this in the 11th district meeting. What was happened to our party and all across our country is political correctness, and people, I've already had people tell me why they voted for someone is because they've done them a favor and they need to vote for them. This is not about personalities, this is about party business. This is the most critical thing we're going to do, and we need to, as individuals, respect what we've done for 238 years and have a secret ballot and be able to vote our conscience. And I'm not worried about somebody with retribution, but why shouldn't we be able to have whatever our voice is? Most people are too intimidated to stand up and do that because they're my friend. I can't vote against my friend. I've seen it for years. We need to do this differently. If we have the ballots, let's use them. Thank you.
Number four.
My name is Sarah Salisbury from Gwinnett County. In an effort to see our delegates retained and our resolutions addressed properly, I would like to see our resolutions voted on before we vote on our slate of candidates so that we can address all of the items that we are here to address today.
Sorry, number four.
Hello, Mr. Chairman. Good to see you again. I am standing in favor of the secret ballot, not out of fear, because I think most people that know me understand that I don't have a problem with letting people know who I'm going to vote for, but simply because I should have a right to if I want to. It's the same thing with spying on us by our government. They say, well, if you aren't doing anything wrong, you shouldn't have a problem with us having access to your phone records. That's not the point. If we want to do our ballots in secret, we should have the right to, whether it's out of fear or for whatever reason. Sir, allow us to use the ballots that we have. Thank you.
Thank you. Number four. And not to rush all of you along, but as soon as I can finish four and five, I have the results of the chairman's race. So I want to share those, but I found it here to quickly finish the debate on the pending motion. We go right ahead.
Mr. Chairman, Nolan Cox, Clowns County.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank you for listening. I have a suggestion. Why don't we take these ballots, put the candidates up there, you give us the numbers, we mark the ballots, put them in a box, count them later, email me and tell me who won. If you email me, I'll get it before I get home. We're talking about modernizing things and speeding up the process. That will do both.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Number four. Order. I want to get through this.
Yes, sir. Dave Lauer from Gwinnett County. Just a few points. One, several of the districts, at least mine and one of others, just passed a resolution saying that we wanted our state representatives to stand up and be counted and let the people know what they're voting for. Another thing, we keep hearing that our history is a secret ballot. No, it's not. Our founding fathers stood up and were counted. And our soldiers have given their lives for us to stand up and be counted. Let's stand up and be counted.
Number four.
I'm with that guy right over there. Let's get the ballots marked and get counted and go and be on the other business.
Number four.
I believe I was misquoted. My intention in my previous statement was not that everybody go home after ballots were all completed and turned in, but those who wanted to stay for the final results would have the ability to stay. My impression of the way the ballots were created was that there is a separate ballot for each vote that is numbered, so that it was entirely possible for us to vote on every candidate as well as every resolution. And then, as long as it takes to count those ballots, would be how long it would take. If there are 1,500 people here, was the intention, I guess my question is, was the intention to count all 1,500 before moving on to the next candidate?
Okay, number four.
This is Oscar Persons. I again, as the chairman, respectfully move to
to call the question. The purpose for calling the question, the purpose for calling the question is when somebody who is in the chair can see that most of the points and arguments have been made and are going on and on, that, he, that the question be called. And I respectfully move.
I thought your call earlier was too premature. I think it is timely. Is there a second to the call of question?
There is a second.
All those in favor say aye. Opposed nay. Hearing none, the ayes have the question's been called. The question is whether or not you have a standing vote. In fairness to you, I want to announce the results of the chairman's race before you vote, just so that I think it's the right thing to do. In the chairman's race, John Padgett received 807 votes. Alex Johnson received 612 votes. Now we have before us a motion for a standing vote on the remained officers. If you vote yay, we will do the remaining officers by standing vote. If you vote nay, then we will do the super ballot as we did with the chairman's race on each race. So if you are in favor of a standing vote, please stand. Thank you. Please be seated. If you are opposed to a standing vote, please stand. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes overwhelmingly have it standing. Hold on. I'm going to take my move right to left. Number two. Wait till it comes on. Number two.
Okay. This is a question I was trying to ask right before the vote. As mechanics, are we going to write everything at once and hand them in as...
No, I'm going to call candidates up. They'll stand here. I will say, if you're for this person, stand up. And if you're for that person, stand up. If I can tell the difference, then I will call it. If I can't tell the difference or if it's close, then I'll have the sergeant arms count. Is there anybody else? Okay, I would ask Michael McNeely. Oh, number four?
Yes, sir. Yes. The previous vote required two-thirds to pass. Did it receive two-thirds?
It exceeded 90%.
Thank you, sir.
Michael McNeely and Jesse Sargent. Please stand up. Please be seated. Michael McNeely is elected. Debbie McCord and Nate Porter. I need all the nominees to come backstage so that I can keep you coming up. We don't have to wait. So if you run for office, you're a candidate, come on back so that we can get the votes done. I'm waiting on Nate Porter. Here we go. All right, are we ready? Everybody ready? This is Debbie McCord. This is Nate Porter. Don't get them confused. Okay? All those in favor of Debbie McCord, please stand up. Thank you. Please be seated. Okay? All those in favor of Nate Porter, please stand up. In the opinion of the chair, Debbie McCord is elected. Thank you.
Next is Mansell McCord and Brittany Marmol. Okay, hold on. Microphone five. Yeah, now hold on, let me get you on. Let me get it turned on. Microphone five.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Just in the interest of fairness, if we know what the result was, I request a standing division of the House with the Sergeant at Arms counting so we'll know for sure who won. Thank you.
Okay. So what will happen is I'm going to take, just so that you know the Roberts rules, I'm going to take the next vote and then you can make the motion. And then there has to be two-thirds that agree to the counted vote. So we'll take that up after the next vote, in case it's not. So the next one is Mansell McCord and Brittany Marmol.
Hey, Brian.
This is Mansell McCord. This is Brittany Marmol. Don't get them confused. Okay, everybody ready? Now, hold on. I have a motion pending, I know, from set microphone five. Microphone five, yes.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Point of parliamentary inquiry.
Certainly.
A division of the House is always in order and requires no vote.
You are correct, but the division of the House can be by standing vote as opposed to counted vote, and that is the difference.
But the difference, Mr. Chairman, is in this standing vote that we had was done with your visual observation. Instead of a division of the House, is a counted division of the House.
I believe, with all due respect for someone who I have the greatest respect for, the parliamentarian has assured me, and I knew independently, that is not accurate.
Well, thank you so much.
So we're about ready. All those in favor of Mansell McCord, please stand. Mansell McCord, please be seated. All those in favor of Brittany Marmol, please stand. So I want you to, please be seated. I want you to notice what I did, contrary to some of my learned colleagues in the field, which is I normally turn to the candidates and I say to them, do you want to count it? And I turned to Brittany and I said, what do you think? And Brittany says, yeah, I'd like to count it. So what we're going to do is we're going to count real quick, okay? So here's what we'll do. If you're for Mansell McCord, I need my sergeant at arms. Right. Okay, so each sergeant at arms, go to your section. Section, each one in their section. So we're going to do it again. Treasurer, all those in favor of Mansell McCord, please stand. General rule of thumb is if the candidate's happy, I'm happy, because they're the ones who've got the most skin in the game.
Next person down.
Is that pizza? Thank you. We ready? Oh, they got it. We're almost there.
Okay.
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 So the vote is Mansell McCord 770. Brittany Marbo 596. So I have, if Nate Porter would come back up. Nate has requested a revote. Debbie McCord agreed. So just because I don't want anybody walking out of here thinking they didn't get their fair chance, because I think these voting patterns tell us pretty much what we know. Let's do this one more time. Yes, Mr. Frost. Number five. Go right ahead. Brad, go ahead. Number five.
Mr. Chairman, I salute you for doing this in the interest of fairness and openness. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. So let's do this again. If you are in favor of Debbie McCord, please stand up. I hate to do this to you, but you have to stand up. He would like a count. So I would ask the Sergeant-at-Arms to count, so that we can see the margin. Stand. noticed that everybody out there had a Chick-fil-A but me. Did you notice that? I want that on the record. Hey, Brad, did you hear that? Everybody had a Chick-fil-A but me. No. Actually, I'd be better. I'll just run down to the Varsity and get me a couple of chili cheese dogs. Are we ready? 1 minute. I can't take you until I have to vote because I'm in the middle of voting. Trust me, I'll get you right. I'm not ignoring you. The vote is 720 for Debbie McCord to 552 for Nate Porter. All right, so we were up to, I think, John Wallace and Mike Hogan, is that right? John? Mike? Oh, and did you have a point in microphone one?
Yes, Terry Turner from Franklin County.
Yeah.
If we have a possible 1,513 votes of delegates, if we get a majority of 757 votes, then there's no need to continue and have a second.
I have to have a motion to that effect.
I make a motion that if a candidate gets more than 757 votes, that we not continue the vote.
Okay. And that's a total cast second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed, nay. The ayes have it. So we're ready for John and Mike.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Mike won.
Mike won. Yes, sir.
We need to. I'm sorry. David Bradley from Union County. We need to understand the process with all due respect to the sergeant at arms, because we have one person coming forward pointing at the people who are standing and having them sit down, and another person who's at the back coming from behind who tell groups of people to sit down.
They've divided it into regions.
So we need the person who is counting to come from the front so we can see you, and you point directly at us and say, all you in both rows 3, 4, and 5, sit down, please.
We'll be happy to modify, but currently what they do is they come at you from both ways, but if it's easier, we'll come from front to back. How about
yes,
that?
Please.
Okay. Guys, move. So we have... Oh, right here. Don't move out of camera range. Come right over here. Stand on the wood. A little closer. Come over here.
Hey, how you doing?
Right there.
1 second, I'm sorry.
John Wallace.
Hold on.
Mike, come up right there. Mike Copert. You still the two? Okay. This is who you're... I'm about to ask. If you are for John Wallace... Whoops. Yeah. What? Camera can't see. Back up, John. Back up. Back. Back. Oh, I need the cameras to focus on John Wallace. John, this is your chance, baby. Look good. All right. Do you see him? No? Back up. Back up. Yep. Back. Now, can you see him? I tell you what, John.
Say hey. Sure.
Do not look at the camera. Do not look at the screen. Look right here. It is a live person. It's a body. If you are voting for John, please stand up. Okay, thanks. Back up. Mike, come through over here.
Hey, Jim.
I'm not counting yet, because you can sit down.
Yeah, I'm getting some of those.
If you were to sit down, sit down. If you're for my Kabachi, did I get it right? Kabachi? Kabachi, please stand up.
Thank you.
I actually want him counted, it looks pretty clear, but no. John Wallace. Next is for Secretary Kirk Shook and John Ferris. John? All right, can you see them? I'll just tell you, yes or no, can you see them? Okay. Kirk, Mayberry. This. I know, no offense, no offense, Kirk, but I did notice the front two rows back up. If you are for Kirk Shook, please stand up. Okay, please be seated. Back up. John, just in case you don't fall. Okay. If you're for John Ferris, please stand up. John, you need a vote, or is that pretty good? Okay, thank you very much. Chuck is elected. I have found, someone has found a Navy Federal Credit Union card. And so we're going to have a raffle. No. Jansen Balissi? Jansen Balissi? Back there? That's right.
Thanks for lunch, Jansen.
All right, so now we have Assistant Secretary. We have Layla, Monica, and Mary Kay. Come on up. Now the way this works is I will first take a vote of the three. If somebody has a clear majority, that'll be it. If there's not a clear majority, we will drop the low and then we'll vote again on the remaining two. Does everybody understand what we're about to do? Okay, so we'll start with Layla. First, can everybody see Layla? All right, Layla. And notice how many gentlemen quickly stepped forward to just grant. I mean, it was amazing. So if you're in favor of Monica, please stand up. In all seriousness, Layla, if you'll move a little closer just so that I could actually see. I know it's dangerous out there. So listen. That's right, I know. All those in favor of Layla, please stand up. Okay, thank you. Please be seated. Monica, be very careful. Yeah, it's tight. So if you're in favor of Monica, please stand up. Okay, thank you. Come on back. And then Mary Kay. If you're in favor of Mary Kay, please stand up.
Are you okay that we have a majority?
Are you okay, Mary Kay, that we have a majority? Okay. So Layla Shipman is elected. If I could add, hold on, Layla, hold on. Because I want everybody that has been elected to come on stage. That would be John Padgett, Mike McNeely, Debbie McCord, Vance McCord, John Wallace, Kirk Shook. If you would all please come on stage. So while they're doing that, before I had a credit card, now I have a driver's license. If your name is Richard Joseph von Scher, Richard Joseph von Scher, are you here? Because otherwise you're going to have trouble with TSA. Here you go, you want to come on up and grab it? Before I finish the, oh, you got it. Ladies and gentlemen, these are your elected officers.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. If you remember at our last convention, we didn't get it finished. And we left here, and I didn't get a chance to say thank you. So, this year I'm going to do a double thank you. Thank you very much, it's a great honor. I assure you, this group of officers and myself will do a great, great job for the Georgia Republican Party. We will be undefeated again after 2016. Those of you that voted for me, God bless you. Those of you that voted against me, God bless you. We've all got to pull together. We don't need to be 2 years getting ourselves together so we're all functioning as a Georgia Republican Party heading into 2016, not at the end of 2016. Y'all have a good evening. Get home safely. Appreciate you being here. I know that. I wasn't going to have another state committee meeting to handle resolutions. Y'all are going to stay here when we finish those things. But anyhow, thank y'all very much. God bless you. We'll see you soon.
Microphone two.
Send me an address. I don't know.
Microphone two, please.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I would like the chair to consider offering a motion to the floor, to the delegation, to refer votes on the referendum to the state committee.
Is there a second? Is there a second?
Second.
I hear a second. Is there a discussion? Yes. Number three? No? No? Okay, so the motion on the floor is a motion to refer. Oh, number one.
Yes, actually, I was at this microphone before he was there.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see you.
Yes, I was going to make a motion that we take up all the resolutions together and vote on them as a package.
Okay. Yes, number two.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not sure we have a quorum left.
Okay.
We need to count them.
Suggestion. Okay. So I have a motion to refer. I have a motion to refer that's been seconded. No debate, no further debate. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
In the opinion of the chair, the nays have it. And so the motion to refer. I now have a motion to consider the resolutions en masse. Is there a second?
Nay.
Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. I now have before you all of the resolutions. If you are in favor of all of the resolutions, you will say yay. If you are opposed to any one resolution, you will say nay. Everybody clear? Everybody understand? So all those in favor of the resolution say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. The resolution for adopted. Yes, sir. Number two. Number two. Hold on. I got to get you on. Number two, go.
Mr. Chairman, is it possible to have a resolution introduced from the floor?
It is not. Under the rules, they have to have been submitted in accordance with the call, and the call specified a deadline. Is there any other business? Do I hear a motion to adjourn? Do I hear a second?
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed nay. The ayes have it.